Greetings, fellow nerds. I'm Soroxy, and today I'll be guiding you all on a curiosity voyage. Okay, with that aside, this video will be my full-length breakdown on Stranger Things Season 4, including the episodes, character breakdowns, and all officially released content up to the time of recording and editing, which at this time is May 20th. Everything I know about this season at this point should be in this video. I might have forgotten something along the way, so please be aware of that, and please let me know in the comments down below. If I'm happy with this video once Volume 1 airs, I might make another one for Volume 2 to go over anything I missed or got wrong, things I got right, and rehashing of theories for Volume 2. In the description below, you can find a Google Doc that has all of my information that I used for this video. You can also find a Google Drive holding all the videos, merch, and pictures I refer to. There's also another drive for stuff that I won't show on screen, but will mention, as technically, though they were released to the public officially, they were taken back or had stuff Netflix doesn't want me to show on screen. But because these were released by official sources and people had public access to them, like buying them or such, they are not considered leaks. Please make sure to refer to the doc and drives while I go over everything, especially the things that I cannot show. I can think a lot of my theories from discussions on the Stranger Things Discord. Please check it out in the description below. This isn't an advertisement, I just love the server and would love if y'all could join me in it. Warning. This video contains heavy spoilers, including, but not limited to, officially released merch, pictures, videos, and more. This video will not include leaks of any sort, and I ask that you do not discuss any leaks in the comments, even if it's to tell me that I'm wrong about something. Just wait until the episodes are officially out. This means no hinting at it either, though you are free to discuss other than that. Without further ado, let's get into the emotional damage that is known as Stranger Things Season 4. We have a map of Rhone County, I don't really know how to say it to be honest, aka the place of Hawkins. Nothing special unless you love to pinpoint where things are. Although someone pointed out the whole thing of the Hargrove Bridge, that could end up being something. A letter from the Duffers telling us there are 5 seasons and how long this season was, including the volume stuff, which was posted a while ago. It also teases some new spin-offs in the future. A few shirts here with Vecna and Elle, which looks insane, honestly. There's a little demo bat on the side, too. Vecna and the door of the Krill House, which looks really ominous. The kids with the Demogorgon and the Krill House in the back, looking dope. Classic Steve Season 4 look. Demo bat with Welcome to Your New Home, Americana, which refers to Hopper. An autopsy of the Demogorgon, which is weird because this one is in Russian format, yet there's the same pic of it on something someone had with H&L on it. That's very weird. The shirt says the same thing on the packing. The saliva is a mixture of food remains and digestive enzymes expelled by the muscular stomach. Solid pieces of food remain trapped inside while the fluid enzyme mixture is expelled onto prey as a form of predigestion. The rest is too blurry to read. That's a little interesting. That might mean that we might see an autopsy Demogorgon. That would be cool. A shirt with L on it, the Morse code says, friends don't tell lies. So maybe that's what she's gonna say from now on instead of just friends don't lie. Like, heck yeah, you know, learning English. A D&D Vecna shirt with the design Eddie made for him, looking gnarly. Another D&D Vecna, but it looks like the actual drawing Eddie made with Hellfire Club and his points written down. Vecna showing his clawed hand, one of the best pics of him, all gross and nasty. Honestly, love this one. I'm tempted to get it. Demobat anatomy, which just labels a tiny bit of it. I actually love this one because the Demobat here looks really funky. Like, look at him go. Dire Demobat. Then Max with candles at the Krill House. Nothing really too much here. Hopper, my main man! Look at his spear. Ugh, his arc is gonna be super cool. Can't have merch without cute party merch. The OG party, nonetheless. Vile Vecna. Okay. I'm sorry, he looks so goofy. Like, yeah, okay, this monster that's gonna murder the entire world is drawn like he's a cartoony villain who wants to make everyone cry for a day. Which was, like, I think an actual plot of the Powerpuff Girls. So, and that's pretty much what I'm gonna do when the volume drops. Both times. This is a cool poster of all the seasons thus far, and a tiny bit of Season 4. Greetings from Cali, just a little bit of the pizza van back there, alluding to the fact that they go into the desert. There are some lipstick and eyeshadow palettes. There's also underwear and stuff, but those just have poster stuff on them, and I don't want to waste time on that, and I don't want to look at that. I will actually get into the eyeshadow palette later. A picture of Dustin that will be hanging in his house, which was actually released a long time ago on their Twitter, and it just told me that they were going to go back into his house. Little info with the Hellfire Club. Here's some cool posters. By the way, if you guys know what those flowers are with the Demogorgon on it, please tell me. They've been on a few pieces of merchandise with the Demogorgon, and I just want to know if it means something or if I'm just going crazy. Because for the life of me, I could not find what type of flower they were. Sour Patch Kids just wanted to share because the Demogorgon on this one looks super funny, and this is one of the ones we made fun of for a few days because we were really deprived of merchandise. Demogorgon and Demobat Toys, which was one of the first looks we actually had of the Demobat, like, a long time ago. He looks so funky. I'm sorry, look at those arms. Some skateboards on a website that have all the seasons thus far on them. You can barely see the season 4 one, but I mean, there's not much there anyways, so. Light Brights, which actually do have a purpose in this show, so I'm curious to see if there's any spoilers with those Light Brights. One of the few whiteboards the crew actually had to show us what, like, kind of stuff they were getting influence on for season 4. I'll pause for a second so you can, like, pause and read. The SFX magazine promo, which I won't show because they made like a big deal about how some of the pics they had weren't supposed to be online for fear of getting in trouble, so I just won't show any of their pics on here. You can find them on the Google Drive. This is just a bit of the promo for it with the map, the cover, and a behind the scenes picture of Dustin, Max, and Lucas looking at the camera. And here are some Funkos. They're so cute. I want them so badly. And now, for the character breakdowns. Starting off strong with character breakdowns is Elle. When I tell you I'm gonna cry because of this season alone, oh, I am not kidding. Eleven's story has always been about growing and changing with the environment, including mimicking those around her in style and everything else. Each season for her is about identity and self-sacrifice. Season 1, she had become a real person outside of being a lab rat and found good in the world, aka Mike and the Party. She sacrificed herself to save them by destroying the Demogorgon and teleporting herself inside the Upside Down. In Season 2, she learned what family was with Hopper and sought her home and family in the cabin, her mother, and Kali and her gang. She didn't sacrifice much except for staying out of the public for a while and closing the gate, of course. Season 3, she learned what being a teenager was and began to make an identity for herself with Max's help. She sacrificed her powers and well-being to keep everyone safe. Each season, this sort of self-sacrifice seems to get bigger and bigger along with her growing identity. Now, this season, it looks like her identity has now been shattered along with the loss of her powers to the point that she's become super aggressive in retaliation. Look at this clip with her attempting to use her powers on Angela after her friend broke Elle's diorama of Hopper. The scream and the way that she thrusts her arm forward was like she was about to murder Angela. I've never seen that kind of raw anger and hatred from her before, at least not on a human being. She was willing to show everyone her powers and hurt Angela like that. In the past, we've seen her use her powers on bullies, but their swift revenge is quiet and small. If her powers worked, I have no doubt Angela would have gone flying into one of those cement blocks and broke her back, or even died. The way the cast and crew describe Elle's story this season always circles back to how she's dealing with the loss of her powers while also facing trauma because she can't push it away anymore. She feels weak and powerless, unable to do anything. But I thought it was going to show itself in her becoming, like, super closed off and quiet, letting things happen because she can't do anything about it. But no. It looks like she will become incredibly aggressive and frustrated to the point of lashing out. Though it seems to be more towards the things that she loves, like Hopper and the diorama. Once again, her protective nature kicks in. It always goes above her own self-worth, it seems. Like, you can pick on me, but screw with my family and you're dead. But, like, tenfold. I'm kind of expecting her to fight Angela at the roller rink for something that she said or did. Maybe about, like, her family. Like Will. Because she's super protective over them. If she does, I would love to see a Jonathan versus Steve parallel. You know, like the fighting style. Just let her go absolutely ham on Angela and, like, have to get pulled off. That could be the reason why Elle goes to jail. Angela, like, called the cops on her for assault. That would be interesting to see, and honestly, Angela deserves it, let's be honest. She can have a little violence. As a treat. And Noah shared a behind-the-scenes video that showed Elle and Will's stunt doubles. Though I will be upset too, because if I'm right about this, that means there's a chance that Elle and Will could get into a fight. Not a physical fight, but, like, a verbal fight. If she's aggressive enough, she could end up getting mad at him. Like, Will is gonna be super protective of Elle this season, so I wouldn't put it past them if Elle ended up getting super irritated and feeling like he's hovering over her, possibly lashing out at him, like, I don't need your help kind of thing. Like a more aggressive version of Will when Joyce was hovering over him in season 2. Heck, I would not even be surprised if this was a build-up to her using that same anger in the final battle. As we know, in season 2, Kali got her to use her anger to bulk her powers up. So, I'm very interested to see if, like, that's where it goes. We will be seeing Elle at her lowest point, and it's looking like that might mean some aggression due to the lack of her powers, plus her being in a whole new environment away from, like, what she knew after losing her dad. I mean, she's even lying to Mike about having friends, which she doesn't. Also, back to the topic of self-sacrifice, every season amps up that along with what I noticed to be self-hatred. Elle blames herself for the gate opening. It's like, since the beginning, she felt it was her fault, even though she really had no control over that. With Vecna as the villain, especially if what he is what I think he is, I think Elle's guilt over the Upside Down leaking into the overworld will become much worse. She genuinely doesn't care about herself if it means helping those that she loves. Even if she's on the verge of death from overusing her powers, she literally does not care. I think that will strike a nerve with everyone, especially Mike this season. We will see Elle get more firm with him, and there's tension, so this could be the reason why. Especially since Elle agrees to go to the silo lab with Owens to get her powers back, even if it means not being in contact with the Kali gang and putting herself through all that stuff again. Her powers seem to be coming back due to memories, possibly remembering all the times she used her powers or just the very first times. This could be why we will see the massacre. I think she might get them back in tiny bits and be like what she was in season 1 because she only has like a glimpse of that massacre, but like that's probably why she goes back to the lab and she has to remember not just for her powers but to know what happened, what she did, what she possibly did, and be like, no, you know, that couldn't have been me type of thing. She could get them back like normal and still want to learn what happened, but this feels more logical and would make her still weak until they really needed her. This season, Elle is going to learn how to be a normal teenager in high school and figuring out her identity, even while stealing Will's clothes, because of course she is, but will have issues with bullying and losing her powers, which looks to be sending her down a pretty dark path, especially since she will have to relive trauma in order to get those powers back, including the massacre. Also, just a little crazy theory. Elle has the ability to lock away feelings of memories, or memories within her head. Like, there's a possibility of that. In Suspicious Minds, Brenner uses the drugs on Terry to mess with her memories and seal away feelings of a bad one so that he could work with her mind easier. Those same drugs that gave Elle her powers. What if she could subconsciously seal away and push away bad memories and trauma without realizing it? Because Millie said it's just so easy for her to use her powers to get rid of things she finds traumatizing, but actually having to deal with them is the more traumatizing part. And that could be why she lost her powers. She accidentally saw that moment as traumatizing enough to subconsciously use her powers and sealed away her abilities by accident, and that's why she has to delve into her memories. Now, this theory honestly doesn't really sound like it would be true at all, but I mean, it's Stranger Things. Anything is possible. And also, with her self-sacrificing type, there's a possibility that Vecna could offer an ultimatum by capturing her friends, and she has to make a deal with him to be a prisoner or like a vessel, so he has nothing standing in his way to conquer and kill as long as her friends are safe. Like, I could see that happening. I'll get into that though, more on Vecna's breakdown. Vecna and the Upside Down. This one's gonna be a little fun. So this season, we will be learning more about the lore of the Upside Down, including the mastermind behind all of the brutality, Vecna, aka the big bad of this season. We are going to be going strong with him. Vecna is a human who has been subjected to the environment of the Upside Down for 20 odd years, aka probably 20 plus. Vecna's body is twisted, and he looks to be having a Demogorgon claw on his left hand, which matches with D&D Vecna's whole hand and eye thing. I think his eye is also blind, but it's very hard to tell right now. Vecna has a clock in the Krill House that has caused several characters to either die or harm others in some form, you know, some sort of way. Victor Krill killed his family, then gouged his own eyes out due to Vecna. It's also speculated that Chrissy also dies due to this clock. If you see the clock, you're screwed. This is confirmed by the Duffer Brothers many, many times. Vecna seems to be having some sort of illusionary powers over those who see the clock, almost like he's literally in their heads. So he could get them to kill others or themselves, even. It's honestly unsure exactly at this moment how his powers could work, but with everything we've seen with Creel, it's very possible that he could make them see horrible things that could make them kill other people. There's a new addition to the demo team called Demobats. They're like a giant flying leech with tendril legs. One isn't too bad, but they can swarm. And they're more like spies who can hang out and watch everything because of the hive mind. And because of the same hive mind, if they know you're there, everything knows you're there. With that in mind, let's take into account Vecna's role models this season. Yes, this little killer has role models. Pennywise, Pinhead, and Freddy Krueger. Freddy is the main influence over this season, especially when it comes to Vecna. Vecna's abilities seem mainly based on illusions and messing with people, especially since he seems so sadistic. He also has control of the Upside Down and considered the like ruler and puppet master. At least that's what I'm getting from everyone, the way that they talk about him. They talk about him like he's like behind everything. He is the original mind of the hive mind that all of the creatures there have. I theorize that Vecna is number one. There's way too much proof to back this for it not to be true. There was even a casting call for a recurring character called Young Boy, whose description was a sensitive and young intelligent boy who keeps to himself most of the time. Like, seriously, does that not sound like a possibility of him being that little number, you know? So, anyways, MK Ultra began in 1953. Then the Creel murders happened in 1959. Project Indigo, aka the Number Project, could have began around the same time as MK Ultra. We know that the Indigo subjects are usually all children kidnapped from their families. It's possible that one was young when he was brought in there around the same time as the MK Ultra project and became a superpower, aka a number. He could have something close to L's powers, but amped up. The Monopoly board in the I Can't Show folder, because of course I can't, says that he can actually open portals. So this tells me he has something similar to what L can do. So there's a possibility that he could have accidentally teleported inside of the Upside Down somehow during maybe like a test or in an attempt to escape. We've seen L do it to herself when she killed the Demogorgon, and he somehow survived all that time, literally 20 plus years in the Upside Down. Like, we saw what happened with Will. We saw that the air is super toxic, so maybe due to his powers and maybe like he was able to live. And maybe he became twisted and angry at the lab people, maybe humanity in general, and just began to build. Then L opened the first gate, and that's why she was able to connect to the Demogorgon so easily, because number 1 and 11's powers are on the same, you know, level, on the same stuff, like all the numbers. Though that's still, as I've said, a theory. Now, the next thing I'm about to mention, this is not a theory, this is 100% confirmed. The Upside Down would then become trapped in limbo from the moment when L connected the worlds together, which is canon. as we will see the Wheeler house and Nancy's room in the Upside Down in 1983, the moment that she opened her gate. It's uncertain if the Upside Down was mimicking the entire time or just at that moment, but I'm honestly betting it did. The timeline fits the 20 plus years perfectly for this theory, along with how everyone describes Vecna having a specific, dark, twisted point of view. Heck, in two of Netflix's Insta stories at the red carpet premiere this year, they asked Joe and Millie if Vecna or Elle had more trauma. Joe said it's a tie, while Millie said Elle. So, take that with what you will. Sadie even says that it's interesting how he chooses his next targets and everything. Everything's just a lot more personal. This dude has a vendetta. Like, it's very obvious. This could also mean that he might be able to make people just see the clock of his own whim, and they don't have to see the physical clock. That's just a little side note. Just a little side note for something else I'm gonna bring up. As for the Mind Flayer, I think he's just an extension of Vecna's mind with the use of his powers. Kind of representing different sides of the same coin, Vecna in D&D is described as a human wizard who became a lich and then a demigod. He's defeated by someone close to him and is sealed away while his eye and hand remain on the normal plane. That could be the human side of the story. The Mind Flayer is described as a creature so ancient it doesn't remember its home. It conquers worlds and creatures and by taking over their minds. Like, that's the monster side of the story. I think Vecna made the Mind Flayer as a means of security to look over the Upside Down after Will escapes, because the Mind Flayer doesn't arrive until season 2 into the next year, because Will doesn't have visions of the Mind Flayer until then. He has normal Upside Down visions. Who will play Vecna? I think Robert Englund will. The SFX magazine has an interview talking about the character. For 5 years now, I wanted to do the Hellraiser / Nightmare on Elm Street with a man in a suit. I wanted Pennywise, Pinhead, Freddy Krueger, that type of villain. Who better to portray a Freddy Krueger type villain than the man behind the melted mask himself? Matt says his jaw dropped when Robert Englund sent in a tape to audition for the part of Victor Creel. No, Victor isn't going to be Vecna. At least I don't think he will. It just doesn't make any sense. I just think that Robert will play Vecna based on this info. Like, come on, it's too perfect. And just, why would you mention Robert after mentioning, like, who better to play the man behind the who better to play a Freddy Krueger type villain than the man behind the melted mask himself? That just screams to me, oh yeah, 100%, you know? This is going to be played by Freddy Krueger dude. Come on, it's too perfect. And it just doesn't make sense to bring up Robert Englund like that when they're talking about Vecna. And the fact that they go out of their way to kind of conceal the identity of who Vecna is being played by, seems a little suspicious. I still don't think Vecna is being, I don't think Vecna is Victor Creel, but I do think he's being played by Robert. It would be literally the greatest thing. Seriously, imagine that. Anyways, with that little spiel out, now, this thing that resides in the Creel house attic, I feel like he's going to be really having a storyline with Elle, especially if he's number one. Since Elle's powers and stories relate back to the Upside Down, as people have said, if Vecna really was number one, then that would mean he was super young when he arrived in the Upside Down, and thus he would have a lot to work out. I feel like Elle is going to figure out who he is and try to help him, since technically they are, who the other could have become. It's like the same coin, but two sides, you know? It's gonna be super sad. Though I don't think there's any way to save Vecna at this point, he's too far gone. As I said before, I think there might be that ultimatum. I'm very excited to see this dude mess people up because he's full, psych horror, and he seems super sadistic. I love it. If he is number one, just imagine what Eleven's going to feel like when she sees him for the first time and realizes who he actually is, possibly realizing that's what she could have become if things got bad enough. And also, Vecna possibly could have other abilities that aren't just what Elle has. I even gave the option of him probably having the ability to adapt, because that's always there. Heck, he could even be a power mimicker. We honest to God do not know anything about this dude, which is insane considering the information that we have on him. We don't know anything. yet we know everything. This dude is going to kick butt. Mike. Mike is up next. Mike's character seems to be a bit more detailed in this season, though we saw a bit of it last season. He's clueless. Of course he is. Apparently, Mike is going to be a lot more clueless this season than when he's not being a leader, because of course. But, of course, he does eventually become a leader again, much more than before. We will see Mike being way more emotional this season, having a huge monologue. This monologue, I think, is going to be, it's going to be very huge. It could be literally anything from a monster fight, pep talk, to a cringy love confession, but my take on it is that it's going to involve a talk with Elle about how he feels about her throwing herself into danger. Yeah, think about it. In season 3, we saw a bit of this when Max and him were arguing about Elle. He loves her and doesn't want anything bad to happen to her, even if she thinks she's doing it for the right reasons. And that's the big word. Thinks. As I said before, Elle is super in her own head about everything and is big on self-sacrifice. She puts herself in front of everyone to protect them in season 3 so much. I think this would take place some point after Elle gets her powers back, after they find her. Mike and the gang wouldn't know what happened until she came back to the van and told them. They would think that Owens or something took them and, like, did something horrible to her, which is why she has her powers back. But Elle went willingly. We know this. So imagine how distraught Mike will be when he learns that she went to get her powers back willingly, subjecting herself to that crap again just because she thinks she's alone in this fight. That she's the only one who could beat this monster. I think Mike will be at his breaking point this season. I think that at some point, he's finally just going to spill how he just loves her, and he doesn't want her to throw herself in the fire just because she has the ability to. She isn't alone in that battle with evil, and it isn't her fault, and he's probably super tired of having to worry about her all the time, while she doesn't even care about herself at this point. I swear to God, if we get a scene where it's like you don't even care about yourself, I don't, or something, I will riot. Because seriously, like, I mean, season 2, he didn't know if she was coming back. Season 1, he literally basically watched her die. I don't like that. I don't like that. The relationship is going to be tested, and this will be very interesting to see play out. On a more positive note, in Hawkins, Mike is going to be in the Hellfire Club and looks up to Eddie, the Dungeon Master. He even grows his hair out to match him, which is super cute. I love that. I think his relationship with Will also be tested this season, as they aren't sitting next to each other and seem to be very distant in all of their shots together. I'm really hoping for some reconciliation this season, as last season we didn't get to see that. I can't wait to see Mike get in his own head until he's got to protect his friends. Kicking into high gear. Give him that push. Like, let's see. I really, really can't wait to see that. I love Clueless Mike. I love everything about Clueless Mike. Let him be stupid for a little bit. Mr. William, aka Will Byers. Heads up on Will, I will be talking about homophobia and slurs for a bit. So be aware of that. That's a warning. Will is going to be interesting this season, since last season he was kind of shoved to the side after 2 seasons of people focusing on him. Will's character seems to be really shaping up to be something much better this season, rather than just being an upside-down detector that doesn't even work. He's going to be dealing with being in a new environment away from his friends and with Elle as his new sister. Same as Elle, he's going to be learning how to be a teenager, a normal teenager in high school for the first time. He's very protective of Elle and Mike when he goes to Cali, which is super nice to see, honestly. I genuinely thought that Elle and Will would have, like, a strained relationship, but no, they genuinely love each other very much and are going to be very strong as siblings. Will is quieter this season, but it seems like he's just bubbling up like I thought. Apparently, he's acting weird and Elle suspects he has a crush. I think this will lead to the reveal that he is, in fact, gay. It's been set up since season 1 with Joyce seeing how Lonnie calls him the F-slur and thought that he was gay and, like, kept calling him, you know, queer and everything. The kids at school also call him a fairy and gay several times. Then in season 3 with the "it's not my fault you like girls" and the, like, talk of Will with Joyce and where she says, "oh, you know, you won't think that it's gross, one day you'll fall in love." Yeah, you could see it as him being ace too. Though you can be gay and aromantic or asexual, it's honestly a spectrum. But there's way too much going for him actually being gay. Like, it's been basically set up since the beginning. Another reason he could be gay, or coming out this season, is his project was done on Alan Turing, who was known as a brilliant mathematician, like he has a bunch of other stuff going on, but was ostracized for being gay. There's a possibility that Will could be bullied for being gay, even with Angela and Elle standing up for him, possibly at the roller rink, as I mentioned before. Like, that whole thing, because, you know, protectiveness. And I originally thought that he might come out to Mike, since they've been best friends since they were really little, and trust each other the most, as seen in season 2, I mean. But now, I think he'll come out to Elle. He and Elle seem to be getting this really close bond, possibly because of the trauma they've endured, you know, being in the Upside Down, both of them having to be in the Upside Down and being subjected to the Mind Flayer's whole thing because he's dramatic and a jerk, and, like, the troubles related to the Upside Down in general. And, of course, being siblings, they have this, like, really, really strong bond together. And if he does have a crush on Mike, I feel it would be best for Elle to know before Mike does. Elle probably doesn't even know what being gay is, much less homophobia. Though, now that she's in school, she's probably heard something like it. But it would be such a great scene to have, like, this little moment between them. And Elle would 100% be there for him and help him through everything. Elle and Will do actually have some talks together, apparently. Like, Noah says that they have discussions together. So this is a very big possibility. I would love that. Especially if Will is helping Elle through her own stuff with Hopper and being in a whole new environment. Like, I'm so happy that they're going to be there for each other and not angry at each other for something. Though, there could also, you know, be that whole aggression thing that I mentioned. 11. But other than that, I think they're really going to be there for each other. And I can't wait to see it. You know, it would also be a really cute scene if, like, Will was like, I like Mike. And I was like, I like him too! Oh my god, we have so much in common! Like, oh, that would be so funny. oh, that would be horrible. But no, I think if he does come out to her, it would be a really good scene. One thing I also want to point out is, this dude is going to be third wheeling Mike and Elle. Like, look how upset he is. Look at him. He wants to protect them because he loves them, but he also wants to be included. I think he will boil over with how he's been treated in the past, too. Like, hopefully, he'll tell Mike how he's felt about how, like, that season 3. Like, he barely got to say it in season 3, how he's been treated and pushed aside and, you know, treated kind of like garbage. Even though technically he was whiny, this dude lost, like, 2 years of his childhood. Give him a chance. Come on, give him a break. Like, for... like, they're not even sitting next to each other! For God's sake, every season, you can look at every single season, Mike and Will are sitting next to each other. I'm not even joking. In season 3, they're even just constantly sitting next to each other. They're, like, on top of each other. It's friggin' hilarious, honestly. I also want Will to hopefully have a better ability than just sensing the Mind Flayer when he's, like, literally standing on top of them. Like, I just want him to be stronger with it. I also want his relationship with Jonathan to shine through. Like, what was going on with Jonathan? Season 3, his relationship with Jonathan was just non-existent, so... but yeah, I really hope that they bring a shine to Will this season, since he was kind of shoved aside last season. He was literally treated like a side character. I'm gonna be real honest about that. I feel like they did it on purpose. I really feel like they did it on purpose. That this would be the best time to bring that up. Lucas. For once, Lucas has a storyline that isn't pushed aside. Though, I do hate how he's once again kind of the bad guy, like he was in season 1. Even though he's not the bad guy, you know what I'm saying? Lucas this season will be on the basketball team, and will become popular. He's still in the Hellfire Club, but isn't nearly as engaged now that he's on the team. He's gonna befriend the other black kid on the team, Patrick, and it looks like they'll be pretty good friends. His reasoning for this change is that he wants to be more, and find who he is, make a name for himself. He wants to start engaging in activities that will make him feel more liked and social, and he wants to really develop himself, especially being one of the few black kids at the school. Lucas and Max have broken up, and it looks like before the season even started. But Lucas will be trying to be there for her for everything. I don't think he was really there for her enough, and that's probably why they broke up, or Max just couldn't handle being in a relationship at that time. I mean, she's closing everybody off. It wouldn't surprise me if she just closed him off too. Which, honestly, would hurt way more. Lucas looks to be much more emotionally available, even with some hiccups, so it looks like he might end up being her support system once the crazy stuff starts happening. He's pushing people away, yet I do think that he will pull them back once he realizes what he's been doing and, you know, and realizing, oh no, I need to be there for them. This is serious. He does need to be his own person, but at the same time, he can't just forget his friends like that. And I don't think he will. I don't think he really will forget his friends. I think he might just spend less time with them, and maybe it might feel like he forgot about them. He might put the basketball team above his friends, like spending time with his friends. And that's gonna hurt. But I do think he will come around. He looks to be growing quite a bit this season, and I'm very, very happy to see that. Max. Okay, warning, this section will include mention of suicide. Or attempted suicide. Oh boy. Okay, so here's a hard hitter this season. One character I knew was gonna be just going through, but not this much! Oh, Jesus. Like, oh man. I had to do so many takes on this, because, like, on her character, it's just, there's so much to talk about. There's not much written down, but I know she's just gonna be going through it. Max is dealing with a lot this season due to Billy's death in season 3. She looks like she might confide in Dustin, as we see her in his room with him, and she looks distressed, like she just said something about her feelings. It will be in the drive. Max and Lucas are broken up. It's most likely due to Max shutting everyone away, as I said, and due to Max's guilt, she might actually end up blaming herself for that. She will be seeing the school counselor and dealing with her stepdad leaving. Yeah, apparently Neil left, which honestly, thank God that dude did not need to stick around. I hated him. And her mom drinking and having two jobs. Her grades are dropping and she's just not doing good at all. She will end up seeing the Creel Clock and Vecna will attack her in some way, so that's gonna be super messed up. Because, of course, why not? This season is really gonna hurt for everything. Oh, everything Max is gonna bring to the table. It's gonna be horrible. Now, one thing Sadie said about Max is really scaring me, because I've thought about this before. This is the warning, by the way. In an interview, Sadie said Max is isolating herself ends up being more harm than good. These thoughts just kind of eat away at her, and eventually, then she cuts herself off and says that that's a spoiler. I think she might be referring to Max possibly attempting suicide. It would be most likely near the end, possibly due to Vecna's influence. It could be due to the depression in general, like a normal type of thing. I'm putting that in quotes because it's not really normal, but it could also be due to Vecna, like if he makes her do it, or he makes her think, like, that if she offs herself, then she won't hurt anyone. Or, like he doesn't make her think that, but, like, she thinks that if she offs herself, then she won't be hurting anyone, kind of like Creel did. Because Vecna was in his head. Made him do all that horrible stuff. Like, that would be horrible to witness. I don't think she will die, though. Like, maybe comatose. Maybe she'll attempt and then she'll comatose. She's suffering with nightmares, headaches, everything. It's just, this would be the nail in the coffin for me, if I'm gonna be honest. Like, it's a lot. Considering everything that Max has gone through, this is going to be, I think, the hardest storyline for me to watch. Every other storyline, I'm kind of like, okay, yeah, you know, I've expected this. I kind of want to see it, like, pushing the characters to their limits. I mean, hell, I spent, like, maybe 10 minutes talking about her trauma and everything. But Max, for some reason, Max is just going to, it's going to hit me harder. I don't know, man. We are not safe this season. Max is going to be absolutely ruined, and it's not going well. I mean, of course it's going to go well, technically. I don't think she's dying. I don't think she's going to go to a place that she can't come back from, but there's also the possibility that, Vecna could possess her. Also, there's a possibility with her whole thing of Billy. Like, you know, how she's, like, super messed up about Billy, there's a possibility that Vecna could use that as a way to lure her into his grasps. This dude is sadistic, and I hate it. Anyways, Dustin, this season is going to be basically the same as always, but better, as always. Woo! Dustin is ramping up to be more social and in the Hellfire Club. He looks up to Eddie, the club's DM and leader, and based on this post, it's possible that he will actually run for club president once Eddie leaves high school, as Eddie is in fact a senior. I feel like he'll kind of see Eddie as his second Steve at school, but way more metalhead. Dustin this season seems to be solving the mysteries as usual, but finally, with the gang by his side, you know? Because every season, he's kind of alone and abandoned. Yeah. There's a shot of him and Max on his bed in his room, and it looks like they might be talking, you know, talking about being alone. I would love that. Honestly, I really would love that. It would really help their characters, bring them together. But they don't seem to be alone for very long as they venture to the Creel house. Dustin most likely will be a lot better this season group-wise. Maybe not feeling like everyone is abandoning him as much, just hoping for that, you know, but they probably will. I'm betting on it. It's kind of a thing with him. But he seems to be doing good other than that, even continuing his love life with Susie. He's still going strong with her. But of course, this isn't a fan of the good stuff, it seems. This season is, it's rough. I'm betting, and kind of hoping, that he kind of snaps on some of them for leaving him behind, like, the last two times. I really need him to call out everyone's BS like he did back in season 3. Heck, he does that all the time. Like, respect my man. I really want him to call them out for what they did, especially in season 3. It's like, dude, come on. Anyways, so that's Dustin. Joyce. Joyce is, of course, going to be going off the rails again, as one does. She is a new mom in a new town, trying to make friends, failing miserably, trying to raise teenagers, probably also failing miserably, but anyways, one of whom is now her new daughter, and they all have trauma. Because of course they do. This is the Byers family we're talking about. You know, they really got it in for that trauma. Jesus Christ. Anyways. So Joyce is a telemarketer who sells encyclopedias over the phone, and she will get a package from Russia, which has a note on it from Hopper. And inside is a Russian nesting doll to tell her that Hopper is alive and he needs help. It's basically a ransom note. So Joyce will join up with Murray and attempt to get Hopper back from Russia with the help of Yuri's plane from Yuri's Fish and Fly, because, yes, this is in Atlanta, by the way. And of course, speaking of this plane, they will be crashing it because Joyce doesn't know how to fly a plane. And I don't think Murray does either. I mean, they live in Hawkins. Well, I think Murray lived somewhere else before, but, you know, that's not the point. I don't think either of them know how to fly a plane. I'm very curious to see if she will actually tell the kids where she's going or lie to them. I mean, there is that discussion scene in the, episode 3 or 4, where they're, like, sitting at a dinner table and they're, like, talking to each other, and they ended up going off the script. I will actually mention that later. It is interesting. I'm very interested to see. If she lies to them, that will kind of suck. Because, I mean, on one hand, it's like, hey, your daughter is sitting there, and she wants to know if her dad is alive, and you're lying to her. To be fair, though, I mean, she wouldn't want to get her hopes up. But if she tells them the truth, will they even let her go? Like, what would even happen? There's going to be a fight. For some reason, there's going to be a fight. I feel like there's going to be a fight regardless of if she tells them the truth or not. Imagine if she, like, tries to not tell them the truth, but then they ended up getting it out of her, and Elle's just like, my dad is alive! Elle needs to call Hopper dad, or else I'm gonna fight someone. Anyways, so, of course, Joyce is going through hell and back to get to Hopper and get him out of there and get him back home, because, of course... Also, speaking of Joyce and Elle, Joyce and Elle will actually connect this season, and Elle will see her as, like, you know, this role model, because she doesn't really have that many feminine role models, female role models in her life, so having this strong mother in her life, oh, love it, I've been waiting to see this since season 1, Joyce has always been there for her, I needed this, I really do need this, but, like, Joyce is just an incredible character, and I really can't wait to see where they go with her this season, knowing that her and Murray will be a comedic duo, which I love, because season 3, oh my god. You're gonna tell me what's happening with my damn magnets on my damn fridge! Why they're falling on my damn fridge! Oh, I love Joyce so much, and the way she interacts with Murray is just great. I mean, I feel like Murray interacting with Joyce was, like, very far in between, and it was more of Hopper, so I'm very interested to see them just really get into it. It's gonna be great. They're both so erratic. Oh, I love their characters so much. They've got to be some of my favorite characters. Joyce will always remain to be one of my favorite characters. But with that aside, there's so much we're going to get to see with Joyce this season. I feel like she's going to grow immensely. I mean, the actor literally said that, like, her choice, her ability to choose is going to be shattered this season. What does that even mean? I feel like she's going to, like, have to decide, okay, am I going to drop everything for this? Am I going to abandon my children for this one little piece of hope? Am I going to trust these people? Like, is that going to be her train of thought? I'm so concerned. Oh, this is going to be a great season. It's going to be great. Hopper. This season, we will be learning a lot about Hopper's backstory and how his death and survival was basically a resurrection. David knew a lot about Hopper's story going into the series before we even saw it on screen. He even answered on an AMA on Reddit, which was official, by the way, saying that we will explore Sarah's death this season. AKA, that means that her death wasn't simply cancer. That's insane to me. There were a lot of theories going around that her death possibly had something to do with the Upside Down and Hawkins Lab, because the, like, hospital that they were in looked like it was the Hawkins Lab. Personally, I just think that they just reused the set, because it was season one. It was season one. But, I mean, anything's possible, really, in this series. Sarah died in New York, but there's a possibility that, of course, you know, her death is supernatural, or even tied to the Vipers, which was a gang in one of the books named Darkness on the Edge of Town. It is an official book. I don't know how many of the books or comics are canon. Most of them, I think, are considered canon. But that has to do with the New York part of his backstory, and we know that we will learn about that, Vietnam, and his dad. David even said that the stuff with his dad ties into the relationship he has with Ellen Joyce. He's gone from this super controlling dad, terrified to lose his new daughter, to being frail, thin, and alone in Russia. The prison in Kamchatka has several demo creatures, by the way, mainly mentioned demo dogs. There might be one Demogorgon, so perhaps we might learn how they got them in the first place, and if they might be breeding them in that prison. We could also learn about the Demogorgon life cycle. Which would actually be really nice. I've been waiting for that since season 2. Like, hey, here are these Demodogs. You want to explain the life cycle and how this thing took, like, only a few days to become a Demodog, and yet there's a bunch of Demodogs and no Demogorgons in a year? Hopper's story is going to have a lot more vulnerability this season. Apparently, he has a really big monologue in episode 5 that has to do with his backstory. Hey, monologue just like Mike. But anyways, in episode 8, there's actually something there that David really liked doing and was really, like, kind of waiting for. He was kind of, like, looking forward to that and has been wanting to do it for a long time. I'm thinking that this could either be the reunion with Joyce or the kiss. You know what kiss I'm talking about. The kiss with Joyce, finally, after all this time. Or, you know, I mean, because Noah did describe this season with an eggplant emoji. I think you all know what that means. I swear to God, if that's actually what it means. I don't even know, man. If that's what it means, I mean, that's what it means. This series has been known to do stuff like that. I mean, they let him go for it. You know what? It's about time. But anyways, it could be a number of things, but, you know, those are just my takes on it. My takes, yeah. I'm just nodding my head. I don't know, man. This Hopper's story is just insane. But anyways, Hopper will at least have a little friend in the prison named Dimitri. He's a guard. Dimitri looks like he'll be helping Hopper escape and maybe even get a special letter to Joyce that we see in episode 1. Monopoly cards say that he will break into prison with a flamethrower by using the sewers. That's disgusting, but also, that is insanely cool. You know, this picture. And there's a church, so, you know, those two things will be really interesting to see. I think maybe that the lines that he was saying in the trailer could be what he's saying in the church. So I think he's really going to find himself this season, and in that church. Perhaps he uses the church to talk about his life and how he wishes that things had been done differently. And the sewer thing could just be him, like, rescuing Dimitri or going back to make sure that he kills those demo creatures and free the prisoners from it. Because, I mean, we do see a dead demo creature in the snow. I'm calling them demo creatures because, like, there's no real... We don't really know if they're all demo dogs or demo gorgons. We don't know. So just demo creatures. But anyways, yeah. We will learn about his backstory and possibly something that happened to Sarah that wasn't really cancer. That is Hopper. What the hell? I'm very excited to see Hopper. We've been waiting for him. I'm very excited to see how he actually survived because I have a theory regarding the ladder. There's no way in hell he jumped through that portal, by the way. If you believe that theory, I'm sorry, there's so much against that theory. I'm not even gonna list it, but if you try to put that theory in the comments, I will fight you. And if it ends up being true, I will fight the Duffers, okay? Like, I'm sorry, they put way too much to make sure that that was not possible, and for them to do it would just be horrendous. If you are watching this after season 4 and that actually happened, I swear to God. Jonathan is struggling in California and has taken to his new buddy Argyle, because, of course, Argyle is helping him in medicinal ways. They smoke weed. They're high off their butts. Yeah, because, of course, honestly, out of all the characters, I saw Jonathan becoming the smoker the most. Dude's in California, he's dealing with moving away from his friends and family, technically family, quote-unquote, and his girlfriend and all that kind of crap. I had a feeling he was gonna... It's California, welcome to the state of weed. They're high off their butts, but... That's actually kind of a good thing, because I feel like he's going to talk about how upset he is about Nancy not joining Mike and coming during spring break to California. So I have a feeling that he and Argyle are kind of going to have a little conversation about that. Also, I think Jonathan works at Surfer Boy Pizza with Argyle. I know that Argyle works there, but there's no confirmation that Jonathan works there. At least I don't think there's confirmation. I've seen so many things, I don't know, okay? I don't know if he works there or not. He most likely does. But, yeah. Like, I mean, I do hope that if he does work there, that we're not going to see a workaholic Jonathan, because last season, it was very, very prominent. I mean, especially in season 1 as well, it's very prominent that, like, the way that his family hierarchy is, he has to work. Because, you know, he's poor. He grew up in a very poor family. So now that Joyce has this really nice house in California, nonetheless, this place is expensive. It looks like maybe the government will give her some hush money. So hopefully, I'm really, really hoping, really praying for this, hopefully Jonathan won't feel like he has to work his butt off just to survive and just to provide for the family. So I'm really hoping that maybe he'll get a chance to just relax. Though maybe the weed is a little bit too far into the relaxation stage. And I know that Joyce will be worried for him. So I'm very curious to see how his character breaks this season. And I say break because all these characters are breaking, okay? This is season 4. Let's go. But yeah, other than that, there's not really much to say about Jonathan this season. So yeah. I mean, it'll be fun to watch him and Argyle and Mike and Will and all that kind of stuff chasing around around the people looking for Eleven, you know? Also, I'm excited to see Jonathan being a big older brother for Eleven. Like, oh, please, I need that so badly. Like, imagine he ruffles her hair and he's like, hey, what's up, kid? You know, like, hey, what's up, Elle? I just really need that. I just really need sibling content this season because I know they're going to destroy these characters. Anyways, that's Jonathan. Steve. Steve is really doing great this season. I say great with air quotes because this man is... He's not doing great. No one's doing great this season because, of course, nobody's doing great this season. It's Stranger Things 4. He's working at the video store with Robin and he's got a bunch of dates now, but I don't think he's actually going to be finding the one for him. He's mainly concerned with keeping everyone safe as usual and being best buds with Robin. The relationship will flourish this season and really grow and strengthen. So I think that's mainly where he's going to find himself. I personally think that Steve is going to have a very interesting little thing that he's doing. He's definitely going to find himself with Lucas, Dustin, and Max. He's probably going to see Max and be like, is this new? To her, like, literally levitating off the ground because he's that kind of person. No. I'm very interested to see where Steve's story goes this season. Because, like, I don't know. They haven't revealed really anything except for the fact that, oh, yeah, he's protecting the kids. He's fighting things. And he's trying to get dates. Like, yes, he's a simp. I mean, literally, while Eddie is, like, getting accused of murdering people, he's too worried about getting a date. It's like, oh my god, Steve. He got his priorities straight. He really got his priorities straight. I do want to see him and Nancy get a connection, you know? Like, reconcile with each other and really, like, fix what they kind of broke in season two. They didn't really have a chance for that. They kind of were just like, oh, yeah. I'm really, really damn good at babysitting kids, you know? Like, that's all we had. That's literally the only thing that we had. So I'm really excited to see if he's going to get a lot of development this season. All the characters seem to be getting a lot of development, so I'm really hopeful for that. Robin. Robin is working at the video store with Mr. Dingus over here. Because, of course, she is besties, you know? And this season looks to be digging into her a lot more than usual. I mean, the actor literally said, oh yeah, this season is going to be digging into her. It's going to get rough. I just know it. But she's finding her clique, her people, and a little bit of love. She's looking to be falling in love with a character named Vicky, who is in band with her. Oh, so cute. There's actually a picture of them in the Don't Show Google Drive. You can actually see them together in band. It is super cute. I think it's at the pep rally. And it looks like Vicky catches her eye. She's like, oh my, a woman. She's like, oh my goodness, it's a woman. I mean, it's funny. I do wonder, though, if Vicky will or will not like her back. Because that would hurt. That would very much hurt if Vicky just did not like her back. I mean, the way Vicky's character is described sounds like something that Robin, you know, that Robin could definitely be like, hello, it is I. And she just, like, falls over head over heels for her. It's like, yes. Anyways, so I'm looking forward to that. I just hope that they don't kill Vicky or anything. Very curious, though, to see maybe if, like, Steve helps her confess her love. And, like, helps her get with that girl. Like, ooh, that would be so cute. Oh, my goodness. Anyways. So, of course, Robin has a really good friendship going on with Nancy now. Because, you know, they're both super smart. They're both, like, into solving mysteries. Although they do seem to have a little bit of difference with how they, like, go about it. I feel like Robin is a little smarter than Nancy. I feel like she's smarter in, like, logical sense. Nancy is smarter in sensing, like, oh, wait. This is interesting. I can hop on this. Whereas Robin seems to be, oh, I know more about this thing. She seems to be more, I mean, the fact that she's in band, she knows some other languages. She's like, oh, I know this thing. I know that thing. I know this. Nancy seems to be more improvisational, creative, whereas Robin is more being able to build off of her sources, you know? So I'm very interested to see how they bond. I feel like they're gonna fight. They're definitely gonna fight. I mean, Robin called Nancy a priss last season, so, you know, I feel like they're probably gonna get into an argument about how they do things. And like, oh, you know, like, if you don't like how I do things, why don't you F off? And she's like, why don't I do that? But yeah, they're gonna squabble, they're gonna fight, it's gonna be fun. But I think they're really gonna learn about each other and about themselves quite a bit. So I'm very interested to see that. And she also joins in with the little, like, the teen gang and everything. Also, I love her outfits this season. Like, she's absolutely killing it this season. Yay! No more sailor suit for a whole season. Anyways, yeah. Nancy. So, speaking of Nancy. Nancy is going full Nancy Drew this season, because of course she is. So she's working at the Hawkins High School newspaper, and she's an editor, which, very interesting. She might actually run into Fred Benson, though I don't know if Fred is, like, a teenager or if he's, like, because it says he's a journalist, so I'll talk more about him later. But she's still hunting mysteries, and she can't seem to, like, see Jonathan and Callie. She can't get away to see him. So I'm curious to see if the reason for that is probably maybe because she has, like, a deadline that she has to meet, or because of the classic, oh, hey, here's a mystery. I'm gonna get sucked into it to the point that it makes me super obsessed and I can't do anything else and end up ruining the relationships around me. Classic Nancy. Classic Nancy. So she could be doing a story on the Krill House, and that's how she kind of gets involved with everything, because, you know, Chrissy's gonna die, so maybe that's her story that she gets. She's like, oh, hey, Krill House time. Let's investigate the murders. Because she and Robin end up actually going to what it looks like the library and, you know, checking some stuff out. So they're probably researching the Krill House murders and stuff about, like, mysterious murders in Hawkins, because there's probably a bunch of other murders that have happened similar to Chrissy's. And, of course, as I said before, I'm very, very intrigued to see how Nancy and Robin really bond this season. I feel like they're going to have one of the best duos. It's going to be so fun to see them interacting. It looks like, also, Steve and Nancy, they look like they're building their relationship again. I mean, like, last few seasons, they weren't really doing anything. As I said with Steve, they didn't seem to really have the best ending to their relationship. They didn't really reconcile. So I'm really hoping that they do, and that they can just build off of each other and say, you know what? I've come this far as a person. I know who I am now. I'm no longer this young person that you knew. Like, Steve's like, I'm no longer this jerk that you knew. And Nancy's like, I'm no longer this meek, perfect, you know, end of the cul-de-sac type of girl that you knew. I mean, she's always been cool with a friggin' the bat and the gun. Love that. Love that. I love that also that bat is Nancy's, but everyone's like, you know what? No, it's Steve's now. Even though Nancy had it, then Jonathan made it into a nail bat. Now it's Steve's nail bat. It comes full circle. Also, Nancy has a possibility of dying this season for possibly a few reasons. So her story is kind of done. Everything she needed to do is done. I mean, she found out who she truly is. She's got an editorial job at the newspaper. She got to be technically a journalist, more of an assistant, but, like, she's kind of done with her story, done with her growing, I feel. I mean, no character's truly done with her growing, but I feel like she'll probably be done with it this season. I mean, and if the season is based on Nightmare on Elm Street 1 and 3, Nancy might die just because of that. The third installment is Dream Warriors. The Nancy in that movie died to Freddy. You want to know who's based off of Freddy this season? Vecna! Yeah, there's a possibility that Nancy could try to avenge Barb's death, and Vecna, of course, is screwing with her with Barb's illusion, because there's literally a Monopoly card that has, not a Monopoly card, there's actually an Uno card that has Barb on it. Barb and Billy. On a season 4 Uno card pack. Yeah. So he could be messing with her with that, and possibly kill her. That would affect so many characters in this series. It would just be a whole snowball effect. I mean, heck, like, if she dies, like, that could be Mike's monologue at, like, a funeral of hers or something. But I don't personally think it is. I personally think it's the one thing I mentioned before. But Nancy could die this season. That is very, if you look at everything with, if she fixes her relationship with Steve, if she fixes her relationship with Jonathan, if she fixes a relationship with Robin, she doesn't really have any more growing to do, to be honest. I mean, she, of course, every character, as I said, does still have growing to do. I don't think she really has any story left to tell. This theory came from the Stranger Things Discord. This moderator, who just kept insisting that it was true, constantly bringing it up, constantly having all these points to point out, yes, this is true, here's my proof. I didn't believe him at first, but then the more he said it, I was like, wait, I don't want to admit it, but you got a point. You got a point, man. Oh, that would hurt. Oh, that's gonna suck if she does die. Rip Nancy, I guess. Oh boy. And that would be, it would be perfect because it would be a main character that could die that would affect like a super good amount of characters without really killing the story, you know? Nancy is the perfect character to kill off out of everybody. I mean, you could kill Jonathan or something, but Nancy, she would affect way more characters. She would be way more of like a martyr. It would be great. I mean, it won't be great, but it'll be great. Erica is now being bumped to a regular, which is super cool. I've been waiting for something like that. Loved her in season 3, absolutely loved her. So she will be taking on more of a leadership role, apparently, and be much more mature. She will be joining Dustin and Mike in the Hellfire Club, taking Lucas's place since he's too busy with basketball. And I can't show that picture, but you can actually see a picture of her with Mike and Dustin at the Hellfire Club. She's wearing, I think that's an American flag that she's wearing as a cape. But yeah, I mean, it's split up, but I mean, you can figure out it's the same picture. It's from SFX magazine, and the way it was, like, it was put on there, it was just bad. It was really bad. But anyways, so she is actually going to be playing with the big dogs. She's going to be in the Hellfire Club doing D&D because apparently her skills are just so impressive that the Hellfire Club was like, okay then, why don't you join us, you know, playing with the high school kids. I mean, there isn't really much to say except for the fact that, like, I guess she'll be coming into her own, realizing, okay, you know, this is who I am as a person. I'm not gonna let anybody tell me otherwise. And I really like that. I was really hoping that we would kind of get that Erica this season, especially after reading Erica the Great, one of the comics, where, like, she makes her friends play D&D with her, and she's, like, super controlling, and she just wants to have fun. So I'm very interested to see an Erica like that this season. I hope we actually see her play D&D. I think that would be super fun. But that's Erica for you. Murray. Oh, one of my favorite characters, especially like in the adult party. Like, literally one of my favorite men on the show. I think he's actually my favorite guy on the show in general. I love this man. He is incredible. He has also been bumped up to being a regular this season, which is incredible. He literally deserves it. I just cannot wait to see him with Joyce this season, a little comedy duo, crashing the plane, Yuri. Anyways, so Murray has had his life screwed over due to sticking his nose where it didn't belong. He's a conspirator, someone who desires the truth so much to the point that it can destroy them and the ones around them. He's super pessimistic and he doesn't trust easily because even though he's all about the truth and he can seek it out of anybody, people lie. And it seems to be a bit too much on him, especially because his life was basically ruined because of lies and truth. I mean, him seeking out the truth, people lying, that's gonna ruin a man. But meeting Hopper and Alexi, those two guys changed that for him. He's become much more open and understanding. I mean, Alexi was the enemy. He was a Russian who literally opened the portal to the Upside Down. But he found common ground with him and loved that man with, like, his whole chest. I mean, the freaking corn dogs, and he's like, hey, go play some rigged games, you know? And the sad thing is, I think this love and understanding and trust will actually become his downfall. I think he's going to trust and open up, but it'll end up getting him killed this season. Yes, I think Murray is going to die this season. I don't think he's making it out of that prison. I don't think he's making it out of Russia. I think he is going to go with Joyce to, you know, help Hopper get out of prison, but he's not making it back. I mean, like, his story is told, just like Nancy. I mean, his story is told, and what better way to send him off than to have him fighting Russians while fighting to, like, keep two people who are in love together, sending them home, freeing them, you know, telling them to rip their clothes off and get it over with. Murray is fulfilled. I think he's going to be fulfilled this season. I think he's going to feel that he played his part, that he did what he came to do, that he was able to do something for this world. And I think he's going to feel like he can kind of pass that purpose to Joyce and Hopper and say, I couldn't really finish my job. You are my job. You know, go save the world, protect the world from these creatures. Because I have a feeling they're going to figure out the Upside Down is, like, really messing with stuff while they're in Russia, so they're probably going to be like, oh no, we got to get to Hawkins. And the way I see him dying this season is I have a feeling he's probably going to sacrifice himself in order to, distract the Russians and probably, like, just long enough so that Joyce and Hopper can just go and get out of there, like, on a plane or through a possible tunnel. Somebody brought up that there's, like, a possibility of, like, a long tunnel going straight to Russia, which, honestly, I don't believe, but, I mean, hey, there's anything that can happen in this show. Also, speaking of the, trusting people thing, apparently he's going to karate chop Yuri because he betrays them. Yeah. Yeah, you heard that right. I don't want him to die this season. I really don't. But it just feels too perfect, just like Nancy. I mean, it would be funny, though, if both of them died, because they're literally the conspirators of the series. They are the characters that are like, huh? Is that a new thing? Honesty? We must search for it, you know? Like they just have to seek the truth, even if it destroys their families and everything. And I love that. I don't want him to go, but it's just way too perfect. Dr. Sam Owens. This man. We know that Owens is coming back to help Elle get her powers back. And, like, to tell her, hey, you need to come to Hawkins because your friends are gonna die. Yeah, okay. So, he knows that something is wrong. He definitely knows that something is wrong in Hawkins, and that the Hawkins gang is, quote-unquote, in the eye of the storm. In the eye of the storm. He pulls over the police van to free Elle so they can talk in a diner. Yes, he is in fact the one in the black sedan. Yes, apparently Eleven is going to jail. And you're going to jail. I'm sorry. Every time that I think of that, you know, whole thing with Eleven going to jail, that's immediately what I think of. I can't help myself. Now, I don't think that Owens will have any, like, ill intentions, just, you know, wanting to save the world, considering last season he saw the portal being opened by the Russians and he was like, the very thing that I tried to stop. Just great. But, Eleven is their only hope, and I think Owens believes that with his full chest, that she's literally the only one who can save them, which of course isn't going to be doing very well with her self-sacrifice and self-hatred that I mentioned earlier. Knew that is not going to be doing good. But the one thing here is there is a possibility that he's working with Dr. Brenner. Yep, you heard me right. There is a possibility that he could actually be working with Brenner to get Eleven's powers back. And of course, Brenner is alive. It has been confirmed that he's alive. It was confirmed, I think, back in season 2. Even, you know, not even in the series, outside of the series. They're like, yep, that man is correct. He is, in fact, alive. Though, of course, you know, creators and stuff are usually liars, and I don't believe them most of the time. This is something that I would definitely say, yeah, he's alive. This is just, you know, them just saying that he's alive. But I don't like it. I really don't like that theory that, you know, Brenner's going to be helping, because just the thought of that is absolutely putrid. Especially because technically Owens would be betraying Eleven, because I don't think he would tell her, oh hey, yeah, the man who literally traumatized you, stole you away from your mother, like, literally made your mother a friggin' vegetable, is, he's here and he's gonna put you through trauma again to get your powers back. That's just not gonna work for me, man. That's just not gonna work. But, I mean, hey, desperate times call for desperate measures. Though I don't feel like he's going to tell her until, like, they're already at the silo lab and it's already too late, and Brenner just, like, steps out and he's like, hello, Eleven. The moment that happens, I'm throwing my screen. I'm sorry. I hate Brenner. But Owens is a good man. He does what he needs to do, and that's the sucky part. Yeah, he threatened Nancy and Jonathan. Yeah, the stuff that he pulled in season 2 wasn't really the greatest. But he genuinely wants to help. He's not a terrible person. He's a person that I would say is misguided. Now, on the subject of people who are not misguided, Dr. Martin Brenner. Dr. Brenner. Okay, I hate this man so much that I ended up actually doing a take where I just kind of ranted about how much I hate him for like 6 minutes straight. When I tell you I hate a character, like, the way that I hate this character, there's a reason for it. I'm not even gonna get into it, but anyways, Brenner is alive. He's confirmed to be alive, and he is coming back this season in the past for certain, but we don't know if he's really coming back in the present. As I said, there's a possibility that he could help Eleven get her powers back, or help Owens get Eleven's powers back, because honestly, he doesn't really work with Eleven. He, freaking scientist man. He definitely survived. The thing is, the reason I think he survived is we never saw his death on screen. All we saw was the Demogorgon jumping on him and slamming him to the ground, and that's it. And then we hear gunshots, like, right after. So, there's a possibility that the Demogorgon jumped on him and then got pissed off because the guys were shooting at him and decided, you know what, I'm not gonna kill this guy, I'm gonna go eat all these other guys. So, Brenner's probably alive. Maybe he has, like, a scar. That would kind of be really cool if he had a scar. But, yeah, I mean, there's not really much. I wonder why he would come back. Like, if he was to help Eleven get her powers back, I wonder why. And also how, like, how either he found how he found, like, Owens, or how Owens found Brenner. It's like, I'm very confused on that. I don't have any information regarding that, to be honest, which is very weird. So, yeah, that's Brenner. I hate this man. I can't wait to watch him die on screen. He better die on screen this season. Or at some point. I just want him dead on my doorstep. Yuri. Okay, so the official description for Yuri, because he's a new character... Yuri is a seedy and unpredictable Russian smuggler who loves bad jokes, cold hard cash, and crunchy-style peanut butter. Yuri is a Russian smuggler, of course, who will give Murray and Joyce a plane to get to Russia. Here's a phone number that was actually sent to fans that had this message. Yuri does backstab Murray and Joyce, and Murray has to kind of karate chop him, though I'm unsure of when, so that's very interesting. There's really nothing much I can say. Here's a picture of him. I love him. He looks great. He looks like he's gonna be a little funky man, you know, until he backstabs them. That's gonna be fun. That's gonna be great. The thing is, I feel like he possibly could have been, like, the place that the note from Hopper got sent from. You know, like, Dimitri used that specific place to get that note through. Because, I mean, Yuri's a smuggler, so it makes sense. Chrissy. So, Chrissy is, once again, a new character, a recurring character. Her official description is Hawkins High lead cheerleader and the most popular girl in school. Oh my goodness! But beneath the seemingly perfect surface lies a dark secret. Uber popular cheerleader type who's desperately trying to hide a dark streak of pain and depression lurking under the surface. She has issues with self-image stemming from her mother's emotional abuse. So Chrissy is 200% going to be the first death we hear about. Or, like, you know, the first death on screen, whatever. She's going to die in the trailer park. I can guarantee that that body bag coming out of that trailer park is hers. So that means she probably lives in that trailer park. And the fact that it mentions her mother's emotional abuse, and we know Vecna likes to use people's, like, stuff against them, I feel like he's probably going to, like, manifest that in her head with the illusions, and that's probably going to be what kills her. So, why is this happening to her? I think that she either, you know, of course, if Vecna can send, like, his clock to people's minds, then he just did that. Or that Chrissy somehow saw the clock by, like, going to the Krill house, because we know that the Krill house is actually technically the, like, local haunted house, so someone could have bet her to go in there, you know, look around. She could have saw the clock, and then bam, Vecna's in her head. Now she's screwed. But, yeah. Either way, she's gonna be the one thing that is going to bring everyone together. Hooray! Hooray, Chrissy! Thank you, Chrissy. Goodbye. You're gonna die, like, in the first episode. Goodbye. Argyle. Argyle. The official description of this man is Argyle. Jonathan's new best friend. Like, I don't know why that's it's written like that, by the way. A fun-loving stoner who proudly delivers delicious pizza pies for Surfer Boy Pizza. A stoner type with a deep, chill, philosophical vibe. Yeah, so he's just gonna be Jonathan's little stoner friend. He's gonna have Jonathan smoke weed medicinally. And he's technically gonna be his therapist who's gonna, like, listen to him and all of his little problems, his little man problems. I have a feeling that, as I said before, he's probably gonna learn about what, like, Nancy, you know, not going to California to see Jonathan. And he's gonna have a problem with that. They're probably gonna have a little scene. That'd be cute. But, yeah, I mean, he's gonna be super cool. Like, oh yeah, let me drive this pizza van. Also, I think it's really neat that he drives Elle and Will to school. He's like, alright, hold on to your butts, bro, chachos. Very excited. I'm also curious to see if his weed ends up being, like, the key to stopping Vecna. I think that would be super funny. I mean, we've been making jokes about it ever since Argyle was revealed, so. Vicky. The official description for this character is a cool, fast-talking band nerd who catches the eye of one of our beloved heroes, Robin. An alternative girl with a cool style. At a glance, she might seem unapproachable, but underneath the clothes and the attitude, she's actually pretty goofy. Oh yeah, this is gonna be the gay moment. This is totally gonna be the gay moment. Yeah, obviously Vicky is going to be the love interest for Robin. This is very obvious. What a wonderful moment. I'm very, as I said before, I'm very curious to see if she'll actually like Robin back, or if she'll be like, haha, no. And I'm curious if they're gonna kill her or, like, make her a part of the team. I mean, she's recurring, so she's probably not gonna really do anything except for be there for Robin's, like, emotional growth. I don't know, she's just there. Peter Ballard, a caring man who works as an orderly at a psychiatric hospital. I can't speak today. Tired of the brutality he witnesses day after day, will Peter finally take a stand? Peter. Okay, so he's really interesting, because, as I said before, we literally, this is the only picture of him. It's just the actor. We don't actually have a picture of the character yet. Like, seriously. And the weird thing is, the Duffers have described the plot at the hospital as, like, critical and pivotal, and I feel like, you know, like, we're gonna have a lot more to do with that hospital than I thought we were. I thought we were just gonna be there for a second and then leave. No, it seems like, yeah, I honestly have no idea what Peter's gonna do, considering he's gonna become a regular. What is he doing? I have no idea. I have literally no clue. I mean, I got no idea. Maybe he is like, oh, hey, something's wrong, and then he ends up getting involved with everything like Eddie does. I don't know, it's just weird that we haven't seen anything of him in any trailer or anything. We haven't seen him at all. It's really concerning. I don't like that, especially because people keep saying that he's number one, which I highly doubt. There's, like, no possible way. I mean, there's a possibility for it, but I really don't want that to happen. I don't think it would make much sense. Eddie Munson. It's about time I finally got to talk about this character. He is a regular, and he's a new character. His official description is, Eddie is an audacious 80s metalhead who runs the Hellfire Club, Hawkins High's official D&D club. Honestly, oh my god, I would love to be in that. I was in a D&D club, super fun. Hated by those who don't understand him, and beloved by those who do, Eddie will find himself at the terrifying epicenter of this season's mystery. 80s metalhead, but nerdy and into Dungeons & Dragons / Metallica. That's awesome. A little scary looking at first glance. So, Eddie is going to be the Dungeon Master, of course, the Hellfire Club. And he's gonna be really good friends with the kids. Though a description with Dustin kind of makes me think that he might have them doing, like, rituals, quote-unquote, to, like, do certain things. I have a feeling he's gonna be kind of like that jerk. Like that senior who has, like, the freshman. He's like, ah, you're my freshman. I'm gonna bully you, but, like, kindly. Like, I love this character already. He's already become an incredible fan favorite. And I don't blame people. I love him, too. He's literally, and he's gonna be really dragged into everything. I mean, he's actually gonna be blamed for Chrissy's death, and possibly a bunch of other deaths that probably happen around Hawkins. It's a satanic panic. I mean, he's a dungeon master, and he likes Dungeons & Dragons, Metallica. They're probably gonna look at him and say, oh, you're doing satanic rituals. So, that's fun. The worst part is, the jocks are gonna be coming after him. That's not fun. So, yeah, and I mean, it looks like he's also going to be hiding out in, the, like, cabin thing at Lover's Lake. You can actually see a couple of pictures of that in the Don't Show document. And, like, the gang is bringing him supplies, because you can see, like, a radio and stuff, so it looks like he's hiding out from, like, the police and the jocks and all that kind of stuff, and just kind of waiting it out. This is probably also where he, like, gets dragged down into the Upside Down. So that's gonna be fun. So I'm very curious to see his relationship with all of these different characters, because we never really get to hear much about that, except for, like, a little bit of his relationship with, like, the Hellfire Club kids. So I'm very interested to see everything. Also, this character could very well die, because he's definitely, they like to kill the fan favorites, but I feel like he's just way too perfect to die. They wrote him in a way that it's like, yes, he's going to die. I mean, everyone's against him, the world's against him, he's gonna have this, like, great rising up, and the Upside Down's going for him, and he's gonna have this great sacrificial thing with the demo bats, and then he's gonna die. No, I personally don't think he's gonna die. I think it's a red herring. I think they made this character perfect for death and are like, yep, nobody's gonna figure out it's gonna be this other character who dies. That's my personal take on it. I think it's way too perfect for death. Lieutenant Colonel Sullivan. Once again, pretty much the rest of these are just going to be, like, recurring characters. But official description for him is, he's an intelligent, no-nonsense man who believes he knows how to stop the evil in Hawkins once and for all. An intimidating, intelligent, no-nonsense man who doesn't remember life before the military. He believes brute force can solve just about any problem. They call him in whenever they want someone to kick E.T.'s ass. Sullivan is very interesting. They mention that he's in the military. You want to know what's the military doing? They're doing this. They're doing this season, and yes, this is confirmed to be military people. So, he's definitely going to be the guy going after 11 this season. Why? No doubt because of the fact that he probably figured out who she was. He probably knows who she is and is like, oh, I have to stop this child. He probably figured out, you know, that who she is based on, like, what she did to Angela, maybe, and is like, oh yeah, she's dangerous. She needs to be apprehended. She needs to be taken to the government, you know, because she belongs technically to the government, because technically she does. And the thing is, I feel like he's gonna try to capture her and be this, like, really antagonistic thing. I mean, he even has, like, a couple of lines with Owens. Apparently he has some lines with Owens. So, I feel like he's gonna be antagonistic, but then he's gonna come around and realize, oh, wait, we actually need this child to do our job. We need this child so that we can stop this evil. I think he's gonna do what it takes to stop this evil, even if that includes letting this child run rampant and be aggressive towards everybody, because we know that she's going to be aggressive towards everybody. Honestly, can't wait to see it. I want her to really just act towards him the way Erica was towards Murray. Having a scene like that would be amazing. just taken right up after her. But yeah, I mean, there's nothing else that I really got on this character. I think he's going to be cool. Jason Carver. His official description is, Jason Carver is a handsome, rich athlete who is dating the most popular girl in school, aka Chrissy. Yeah. Yeah. As a new evil threatens Hawkins, his perfect world begins to unravel. A preppy, handsome, rich kid. Not just a jock, but very much a jock, but also a master of smarm. I don't know what smarm is, but I don't want to know. So, yeah, he's dating Chrissy, and he's going to be very pissed at the fact that his girlfriend just died. So yeah, he is definitely going to be leading that whole chase on Eddie. There's no doubt in my mind. I mean, like, it looks like him and the jocks are in a hospital thing. It looks like a school nurse thing, and they have newspapers in their hands. So they probably learned about the death and are like, hey, we're going to murder this man. Yeah, they're definitely going to blame him. As I said, satanic panic, it's running rampant. There is a part, where they, like, go to the cabin. They go to Hopper's cabin because Lucas lies to them about where Eddie is. So that'll be interesting. They're going to murder this man. I'm very curious to see what exactly they're going to do throughout the series, except for try to murder this man. I don't think they're going to do anything but try to murder this man. It's going to be fun. But also, there is a possibility that he is going to bully Lucas and his friends. I mean, Lucas is a new kid, like, on the basketball team, and his friends are nerds. So, yeah. Because there's got to be that tension. You got to have that tension with his friends and everything. You got to have that, oh my god, your new friends are bullying us type of thing. The classic. Victor Creel. The official description for Victor is, Victor Creel is a disturbed and intimidating man who is imprisoned in a psychiatric hospital for a gruesome murder in the 1950s. This is the man behind the slaughter. No, I'm kidding. Victor was possibly the first victim of Vecna and his clock. He recently moved in with his family and then saw the clock and killed his family. Now, we don't know how exactly he would see his clock, whether it has to be physical or not physical, where Vecna just chooses him and is like, okay, you're dead. Later on, he actually gouges his eyes out. We don't know whether or not this is right after or a little while later. He says he felt relieved and then horrible. I'm guessing he was referring to something to do with why he killed them. I think he killed them because Vecna made him see a horrible illusion that he thought he had no choice but to kill. He probably gouged his eyes out because of Vecna. Or so that he didn't have to see any more, like, horrible illusions. So Vecna could have either made him do it or he wanted to do it. I don't think he really had any huge role other than to guide the gang to the truth, though his role is described as pivotal and critical. And then, of course, there's Peter Ballard. Now, I didn't mention this with Peter before, but he was actually mentioned in the 8-minute clip of the first episode. He was mentioned by Brenner, who ran to the intercom and said, Peter. We don't know if this is the same Peter or not, and there's a possibility that Peter and Victor could have worked at H&L. It is also possible that Victor maybe had something to do with number one, and so did Peter. There's a big possibility for both of those, considering that Peter's a regular, and Victor Creel seems to be having more of a story than we're kind of leading on. I originally thought that Victor did have a sort of role to play at H&L, that he might have moved there so he could work there, but I'm not too sure. I mean, anything could really happen, considering the fact that he is new to town, and he died within the year, it looks like. He still could have worked at H&L, or he just so happened to have some sort of, like, clock, you know, the clock in his house, in his attic, considering the fact that Vecna does live in that attic. It's weird because Victor is with Peter in the psychiatric hospital. Peter works there. So if Peter was at H&L, then all of a sudden he's at the psychiatric hospital. What exactly happened for him to want to go? And then considering the fact that Victor is there, as I said before, there could be a connection with number one, and maybe he's, like, keeping an eye out for possibly, like, people who number one affected. I'm not too sure, just because of the fact that Peter is considered a regular. But really, I mean, there's nothing hinting at anything, but at the same time, it's so much lack of context, really. It's just a bunch of different pieces of information without any context. I don't have any clue to what's going on. Dimitri. Dimitri's official description is a Russian prison guard who befriends Hopper. Dimitri is smart, cunning, and charming, but can he be trusted? So we don't really have that much on him except for maybe like a few pictures. And he was definitely in the From Russia with Love teaser. So yeah, that's the thing. He's definitely going to be the one to, like, hand off that letter to Joyce. He's definitely the one either who made that letter, or he definitely sent it for Hopper. He's going to be helping Hopper out. I don't know why. Maybe because Hopper knows something about the Demogorgon, and he's like, hey, I don't like working here, and there's a giant monster, so could you, like, get rid of it? So, it could be just that he doesn't want to die to that Demogorgon. And, of course, you know, Yuri's smuggling, so he most likely knows Yuri, like, as a friend or something. I don't know. But it does look like he's going to get caught. This scene right here, it looks like Dimitri's in the middle of the demo pit, getting ready to face off against the Demogorgon. So it looks like he gets caught, and he's probably going to die. I'm very curious to see, you know, all of this kind of play out. And I'm curious to see if, I don't know, you know? I really, honestly, I don't know what's going to happen with Dimitri. All I know is he's going to help Hopper, and he's probably going to die in the demo pit. That's it. Not much on him. Patrick. His official description is a Hawkins basketball star who has friends, talent, and a good life, until shocking events sends his life spiraling out of control. Patrick and Lucas are one of the, like, some of the few only black kids in the school, and so they seem to, like, really connect on that front. They're also both on the basketball team, and so I feel like they're really going to connect, and Patrick isn't really going to be a jerk towards Lucas and his friends, like all the other jocks most likely will. I feel like he'll probably stand up to Jason and try to be like, hey, why don't we stop picking on these kids? Why don't we stop trying to murder Eddie for doing something that we don't even know if he did? I think he's going to probably help the kids out and, like, maybe create distractions, but either way, this is really all we have on this character so far, so that's Patrick. Miss Kelly. Her official description is a popular guidance counselor who cares deeply for her students, especially those struggling the most. A kind-eyed high school guidance counselor, she cares about her students, and she's good at her job. There's actually a scene of Kelly talking to Max about, like, her trauma and how she's doing it at the moment. And the way that she responds, honestly, like, it makes me think, this is a dope guidance counselor. This is a guidance counselor that everyone wishes they had. She is super cool. Like, you can't tell me that she doesn't genuinely care about her students. I mean, the description is right there. But the way she responded, it's almost like talking to a friend, and they're like, are you serious? You need to get some sleep, bro. Like, this isn't good for you either. Like, you know, it's talking to a friend rather than an adult, you know, someone who is above you. It's kind of like talking to somebody who's on your same level. And honestly, I really like that. I'm very interested to see where this all goes. What's also interesting is we will get to see Miss Kelly's house. I originally thought that maybe Max would be going to her house for, like, sessions because of the fact it was on the Monopoly board, but it doesn't look like that. It looks like she might be going to, you know, just the school for those sessions. So I don't know how her house is really going to play into any of this. And it looks like, I mean, it looks like she's going to have quite a bit of stuff going on, considering that she's probably connected to a bunch of the, like, depressed students. So they're probably going to end up finding out a lot of information regarding Vecna and Chrissy. But honestly, there's not really much that I can talk about here. Miss Kelly is just kind of there. There's not much information to go off of, but I have a feeling they're probably going to do her character very well, and I'm going to have a very fun time rewatching all of her scenes, especially the one I just showed. By the way, that shot is very cinematic. That is, like, one of my favorite clips so far. It is done so very well. This season is amazing so far. Fred Benson. Okay, so his official description is a dorky, four-eyed kid with a love for journalism. Fred can sometimes be off-putting to others. This is the man. This is the absolute child. This is literally him. I've been saying since day one that this character is not Will. This character cannot be possibly any character that we know because of the haircut. I was specifically pointing out the fact that the hair swoops at the bottom, at the nape of the neck, and then it has a part on the left side. This dude has that haircut, the exact haircut. So why in the world is he walking towards a burning car in the middle of the night? I'm gonna guess that it's Vecna. And that's probably a super traumatic experience for him that he went through as a child or something. very curious. But anyways, he definitely is going to be seeing a lot of stuff regarding the Upside Down. He's probably gonna, like, investigate. I think he's gonna be, like, a Hawkins dude, and he might even be working with Nancy. And I think he's going to get involved with all the Upside Down stuff and end up finding the clock or something and be like, haha, I'm in danger, you know? But really, that's all I can think about, is he's just going to be kind of doing the same thing Nancy's doing. He might even, like, compete with her to get that story done. But that's really all I got on Fred. I'm terrified. Terrified why they would introduce such a character. Especially because we do not see anything of this character yet. Angela. Her official description is a queen bee who is equal parts type A popular girl and diabolic bully. We all know who Angela is. Everyone knows who Angela is. Angela is Eleven's bully in California. She's a grade A jerk. I hate her. I'm going to murder her with my bare hands. Seriously, though. I was expecting, you know, a lighter bully, not one who will literally destroy her diorama, make fun of her in front of everybody. I don't know, she seems aggressive. Very aggressive. I don't know, man. Like, there's gotta be, like, honestly, she deserves to get her butt whooped. She really does. There's not really much on Angela, other than the fact that she's just constantly gonna be bullying Elle. I mean, her whole purpose as a character is probably just to bring out the worst in Elle and be like, haha, funny, look at you being all aggressive. Like, that's just great. That's just great. But yeah, I mean, there's really nothing else that I have on her. So that's Angela, everybody. Woo! Jake. Not much on this character. He's just Eleven's secondary bully. He's gonna be helping Angela. He could be her boyfriend, you know, but he's definitely just gonna be helping Angela bully Elle. That's literally it. I mean, like, that's actually it. I mean, he didn't even have a character description when they posted him on the casting call, so that's it. Warden Hatch. The official description for this character is a pretentious and smug head of a psychiatric hospital. This character seems to just kind of be there as an antagonist to Peter Ballard. I don't really know what they'll be doing. They're just a recurring character, so there's not really anything to say about them. Overall theories for the season. Okay, here are some overall theories and things that I picked up on, but I don't really have a specific place to put them, as they don't have enough context for me to place them in a specific episode or with a specific character. We will start by getting the first 7 episodes on May 27th. This has been confirmed officially onto Dumb. I honestly hate this decision, personally, because, you know, I was kind of hoping, okay, we get 5 episodes, and then we'll get 4 episodes. I mean, yeah, it doesn't feel balanced. It's like 9 hours, and then 4 hours. AKA, we are gonna get left on a cliffhanger for a whole month on the massacre episode. Because of course we are. They don't want us to be happy. They want us to suffer as much as possible. But you know what? Fair. I also want to say that each episode was around $30 million in budget. So around $270 million overall for this season. That's more than a Marvel movie. Seriously. Literally go look it up. It's more than I think No Way Home had the budget for. That's a Marvel movie. What did they use the money for? I know what they used the money for. They used it for amazing CGI and amazing just everything. Just what I've seen so far, this season is going to be incredible. The funny thing is that's like 3 times the budget of season 3. Every season went up, you know, maybe 10 to 20 million or so. We never even hit the 100 million. And now we're almost at $300 million in budget. That is insane. That is such a jump. Wow. And it's funny because the Duffers asked for a 9th episode because they originally had only 8. But they asked Netflix, hey, we need a 9th episode. And Netflix was like, all right, here you go. It just proves this show is Netflix's, like, child. They love this show. I mean, it does bring them some of the most money. Most of the episodes are, at average, an hour 15. The cast isn't allowed to say nearly anything about anything. Like, we've barely gotten anything from them in interviews. All they can really describe this season as is bloody, horrific, terrifying, gruesome, scary, bigger, all the higher stakes, everything is literally the same answer. Which really tells us something, that they can barely say anything about what's happening in this season. They are really keeping it under wraps. I've never seen them do that before. Some of the episodes will have endings that will make you not want to turn on the next episode. I want to know what they mean by that. I bet it's just absolutely terrifying. They said that's mainly at the beginning, so... Oh no. The Duffers, I'm very happy that they actually had the pandemic, because that pandemic gave them a good 6 months to look at all of the scripts and end up connecting them and writing them fully all the way through before filming, because usually they write an episode, they write like half of the episodes, and then they start filming while they're also continuing to write the episodes for the rest of the season. They didn't have to do that this time. This time they got to sit down and write all of the episodes out and really begin to connect everything, and they even got to outline season 5. This is telling me this season is going to be a lot better in continuity, and the way it's going to flow is just going to feel so good. I'm actually very happy that we had to wait this long, because imagine if we didn't wait this long. They wouldn't have had an amazing season. And I guarantee, if you come back to watch this after you watch the season, you're going to agree with me on this. With the character posters, we can see each group has a certain color and sentence that goes along with them. Eagle's Nest, do you copy? Good morning, 11. Hawkins, do you copy? Scoops Troop, do you copy? Hellfire, do you copy? And the most important, Wheelers, do you copy? This is important because Karen has now joined the team. She will officially be learning what's happening in the town and joining the team, most likely starting with Nancy. It's uncertain just how involved she will be, but hey, at least she's there. Noah described this scene with a scared emoji, pizza emoji, and an eggplant emoji. I want to know why. I want to know why. Oh, Jesus. What the hell, Noah? Now, we have some Uno cards of the characters that I cannot show, but one thing sticks out. Billy and Barb are included. That means that they will be shown in the season in some form. I think it's just referring to them coming back as illusions made by Vecna to taunt Nancy and Max. I don't think they're coming alive, because there's no way in hell that they are going to be revived this season. At some point, the grown-ups are going to be getting involved. Though I can't really pinpoint exactly when or how, but it looks like it's near the end. We can see it in the pictures that I can't show, so you're gonna have to look in the can't show drive. The adults are talking to Dustin, Max, and Lucas, and given the clothing, it's definitely near the end. This, I think, is when Karen will probably start to get involved, or she'll get involved beforehand and then tell the other parents. I don't know, I'm not really sure, and I'm not sure why the police are even getting involved in the first place. Maybe it has something to do with Eddie? A Monopoly card says Hopper will be fighting a Demogorgon while Elle is facing her traumatic past. There's a chance that these two things could be taking place in episode 7. A phone number came out at some point that was Murray telling us that if we weren't Joyce or his mom, to not call him back. And if I remember correctly, it also had Murray telling Joyce that he found something out. I don't remember if he said it was about Hopper or not. It was changed a little while after, so, to just be, like, the don't call stuff. But, yeah, that came out, like, a long time ago, about around last year. There is, in fact, a dinner scene, as I will bring up later, stated by Charlie, with the Cali gang and Joyce and Murray somewhere in episode 3 or 4. Apparently, they did a lot of outtakes where it looks like they probably went off script a bit. very likely to get very heated. Noah also mentions in an interview about Alaska. He didn't mention Russia when he was referring to the different locations. And Yuri's fish and fly is located in Alaska, so there's a possibility that Joyce could tell the kids what her plans are to save Hopper, and, you know, that they can't go with her. And that could result in a heated moment. Or, of course, she could lie to them and tell them that she's going to Alaska for a bit and will be back. Either way, I don't think this scene is going to be going very well. On a weird note, there was a fire in Albuquerque, New Mexico on the set of season 4. This is where the California plotline is being shot, by the way. It's possible that it was an accident, or even that it was intentional, but it kind of got out of hand to the point that the firefighters needed to be called. Maya mentioned how they would have to react to some sort of, like, natural disasters, and I'm thinking she was referring to earthquakes, maybe caused by the Upside Down leaking into the overworld, like, causing, you know, like, earthquakes to happen all around with the portals opening, like a tear, because we've seen that it really rips a fabric through reality. And the reason that I think this is because out of all of the natural disasters that you have to fake, that one I feel would be the most awkward. And she did say that it was, you know, it was weird. Max will see a clock in the school, though this could be an illusion at the graveyard or even the episode before that. Anything is possible. There will also be a Max at the snowball in the past, but a balloon pops behind her, so possibly another illusion, or a nightmare even. There's another Monopoly card that mentions someone being in a trance at a high school bathroom, but I'm not sure who it could be. It could be Nancy, Max, Chrissy, hell, anyone's up for grabs at this point. Eddie will be blamed for the murders in Hawkins, and the gang will meet him at Lover's Lake, where he will be taken into the Upside Down, but I have no exact timing on that. They had to probably find Eddie in the video store database due to the Monopoly cards. Also, Robin has a line that's like, wow, that's a lot of Ricks, so maybe it could, you know, correlate with that. By the way, this season is based on a lot of things, but mainly Nightmare on Elm Street, specifically 1 and 3. Lonnie will for sure be returning at some point in this season in some form. As we see in a table read video, that's Lonnie's actor right there. It could be in the past, it could be in the present. I don't know why he would even be in this season in the first place. Steve and Eddie will be a bit at odds, with Dustin being kind of in the middle because of their relationship with him. Here's how I think this sequence will go. Elle has to go to jail, possibly because, of course, she fights Angela or gets too rough, or, you know, Sullivan maybe even just had it out for her, and she will be taken in that prison van. But then, later on, she'll get freed by Owens in the black sedans. And the Lenora police officer will most likely go to the buyer's home to ask where Eleven is, now that she's broken out of police custody. But they don't know where she is either, and now they're probably freaking out because they're like, what do you mean you lost her? You're supposed to- she was in police custody! She doesn't even have powers! How did you lose the child? The officer could stay until the next morning, or will wait for them to call. Ellen Owens will meet at a diner for 5 minutes, and Elle knows that she has to get her powers back to help Hawkins. She definitely agrees to do this. Next morning, Sullivan's men raid the buyer's home, and the officer helps defend until they leave, possibly because they don't know where Elle is. Sullivan probably figured out who Elle was once she got arrested. Now, the Cali gang knows Elle is in trouble and will set off to find her, going to Susie's house because she's a computer wizard and, you know, she needs to hack probably something, maybe the radios or something with the military, to figure out where they took Eleven. They'll get to the silo lab probably after Sullivan arrived and will most likely witness Eleven blowing it to smithereens. Yeah, that's my theory on that, how that whole sequence will play out. Another thing, in the Kamchatka comic, a man in Russia made this device and was taken prisoner because he refused to use it to keep the Demogorgon alive. In the Far Cry 6 Stranger Things DLC, a Russian woman had the same telekinetic device, or a similar one, and had the same abilities as Elle, but with teleportation. I think that this is actually going to become very important later on, possibly even the reason why they still have a Demogorgon, like even after the hive mind's been cut off, and how possibly they have several demo creatures. Lucas and Max will explore the Creel house, most likely in the Upside Down as it describes it with fog and spores. Someone will be in a familiar empty swimming pool. Could be this shot, just because of the way that the background is different. It's darker on the top than it is near the bottom, which kind of makes it look like the bottom is a little bit closer to us. Kind of like you're in a little box and the top, it looks further away. You know what I'm talking about? Now, on the subject of these pictures, it's possible that this could be a dream where Max sees the clock and tells them that they have to go to the school to find something. Or Max, Dustin, and Steve get in the car and drive to the school to find something that could help them for a different reason. And Max maybe finds the clock in the wall as an illusion. They seem to be in Miss Kelly's office in the school, based on the background. And maybe they could be looking at Chrissy's files to see if, like, that could be part of the reason she died. As for Max, it could be the first or second time that she's seen the clock, depending on how Vecna's clock works, and whether he can make you see it, or, like, have to look at the physical clock first. This, of course, would take place at the same day as the Krill House adventure. But that's the thing. These other pictures take place in the same day, too. So how could they go to school at night, and Billy's grave at night? This is super confusing, because they both... Because we know for a fact that they end up at the grave earlier in the day, and it turns into night. So would they go to the school afterwards? Because they're in the car during the day as well. And, like, that's... It's incredibly confusing due to the lack of costume change and the lighting. Like, I got no idea what's going on. Unless, like, Max makes them drive to the graveyard so she can talk to Billy's ghost or something that's coming, like, through the little radio she has. And, like, maybe Lucas meets up with them a little bit later, and then the whole thing happens. And then they go... Maybe Lucas has to leave, and then they go to the school to check something out. Maybe the school even could be an illusion? I have no clue. Okay, one tiny joke thing. Maya, in two separate interviews, basically mentioned that Robin is in love with Nancy and avenges her death. As a joke, of course, but, imagine if that was actually hinting at Robin, like, falling for Nancy and, like, avenging her death. That would be hilarious, considering how they, like, how Nancy probably would see her as a weirdo back then, whereas Robin saw her as a priss. Honestly, that's kind of funny. It's just funny, the fact that it's two separate interviews with the same, basically the same answer. And that's all I have on the overall theories. Episode 1, The Hellfire Club. The first episode of Stranger Things Season 4 is The Hellfire Club. It will run for about 1 hour and 17 minutes based on how people are talking about it from the premiere. Some people also got to see the first 5 episodes or so, and they all say the same thing, that this episode is 1 hour and 17 minutes. This is the only title that we actually know for certain is a real title. We got to see the title page for this script a long time ago on Twitter. This episode will focus heavily on getting back with these characters and showing us how everyone is doing. It'll dig really, really deep into how everyone's growing and developing and becoming their own person in their own little world. Due to us getting the first 8 minutes officially, that has been officially released now, I will now be talking about that. Trust me, this is gonna get rough. So now we know that the episode will begin by showing us that Brenner is in fact alive, and he's living in a nice little bungalow. We don't really know exactly where he's living, but it looks kind of like it'd be a similar place to Hawkins. If not, he's living in Hawkins. And he looks to be doing just fine on his own, that's for certain. So, the episode actually flashes back to September 8th, 1979, to show us Hawkins Lab Laboratories. Now that's one thing that was actually a little interesting, is it's not laboratory, it's laboratories. It was just something that somebody noticed, and I'm like, hey, I should add that, that's probably important. It flashes back to this time, and all of the other kids are happy, healthy, technically happy, Stockholm Syndrome, you know. And they are just enjoying themselves in the Rainbow Room, using their powers. And it looks like a lot of those kids have similar powers to Eleven, like telekinesis, telepathy. Some of them look like they have... I don't really know. The only ones that we got to see were telepathy and telekinesis, including number 10. Number 10, who was actually brought back by Brenner to do a test using, you know, his remote viewing to see what Brenner was drawing. He also used it to see into one of the other patients' rooms to see how their testing was going, but he ended up watching them die. So this is when it gets really rough. Everyone just dies in the lab. All of the guards, all of the kids, they're all dead. The door gets swung open, just thrown off of its hinges, and hits Brenner in the face, knocking him out, And then when he wakes up, Ten is dead on the floor next to him. And it looks like his arm is, like, completely twisted, like his wrist was just snapped backwards. And it looks like that little stuff on his arm is, like, the twisting of the skin. Though it kind of looks like scratch marks, you know? Like, when you get scratched by your cat, and it doesn't break the skin, but it just kind of, like, puffs up. That's kind of what it looks like. And there's a little bit of blood on his gown, but other than that, he doesn't really look harmed, so someone probably snapped his neck. Speaking of that someone, when Brenner gets up and he goes to see what happened to the others, he finds everyone dead in different positions. Some are covered in blood, some are not. A lot of them are very twisted and bent, like someone broke their body, like all of their bones from the inside. I guess we now know what Maya meant when she was talking about how some of the most gruesome stuff on this show was going to be bones breaking. Yeah, they really weren't kidding about that, were they? But by the time that he gets to the Rainbow Room, everyone is dead, and he sees Eleven standing in front of the broken mirror, and when she turns to see him after he says, "What have you done?" She's breathing very heavily and covered in blood, and her eyes are bleeding, and so is her nose and her ears. Her eyes have never bled before. I thought that they did, but apparently they didn't, so that's a little concerning. Now, my theory on what could have happened here is probably that Vecna got involved. So, yeah. Now, my theory, of course, on how this happened has been mentioned before. This is really messed up, and I don't think Eleven is capable, nor would she ever want to do anything like that. Especially considering the brutality that has just been committed. It's not even just killing all of those people. Twisting their bodies in such a way that they're broken and just destroyed. It's literally disgusting. So, after that whole incident, we are most likely going to move into more, I guess, better stuff. You know, not nearly as dark as whatever that was. So, at some point, we will see Hopper's survival. We will see how he survived the explosion. I personally believe that he went down the ladder that leads down into the pit right before the explosion. You know, this ladder, right here. There's a ladder right here, and you can see he's here one moment, and then the next, he's gone. Ladder. Has to be the ladder. So, I personally believe that when he goes down the ladder, and he's trying to escape, Russians ended up rushing him, you know, because they're Russians, and they ended up capturing him while they were trying to get away. Now, how they were able to get back to Russia and bring him back to Russia without most of them getting caught, someone brought up an interesting idea that there was a tunnel that led all the way to Russia. Which, considering the fact that there definitely was a spy in Hawkins watching the Hawkins laboratory, because of the fact that the Russians know about the Upside Down and how to get into the Upside Down, there most likely has been a spy there for quite some time. So there is a possibility that they did have those resources and that amount of time to build a tunnel like that. It's honestly the only, you know, logical explanation, other than, like, maybe planes or, like, I don't know, ships. Either way, it's going to be very interesting to see how they get back to Hawkins. So, we will move on to showing where everyone is at the season, most likely starting with the party in Hawkins at the pep rally in the school. The kids don't seem to very, you know, they don't seem to like it very much, but they're there to support Lucas, as he's on the basketball team. Because it's a pep rally, because of course. So, the one thing is, the boys are looking very shocked while the crowd is cheering, and then Max looks like she's about to cry or that she's crying. She looks very upset. I don't think it's anything like, oh, Lucas is cheating on her. First of all, they're broken up, but, like, Max doesn't get that upset about normal things, and even when she gets upset, she kind of just shuts it out. She's about to cry or she's crying. The only logical explanation that I have for this is, like, something to do with Billy or the Star Court Mall. Considering it's a pep rally and considering how popular Billy was, especially on the basketball team, they might bring up his death as like a martyr or something. That's the only thing I can really think about to see why the crowd is cheering and why they're all upset. Like, bringing up his death and bringing up the Star Court Mall deaths, because there were a lot of people who died there. like, to say, oh, yeah, you know, like, these guys, you know, they didn't, we need to make sure that they didn't die for nothing. Like, I mean, I could see them doing that, considering the route that we're definitely going this season. I could see them doing something like that. I don't have any confirmation on that, though. This is more of just, like, figuring it out, because everything else doesn't really stick. Now, the thing is, I don't think they'll be mean about it. I think it's just, like, bringing it up, and Max is like, are you serious? You seriously saying this right now? Oh my god. It's more of, like, insensitive. Like, I mean, even Lucas, the way he's looking, there's a picture, it looks like he's like, oh, this isn't that good. Or he's just looking at Max, trying to get her to look at him, but she doesn't want to look at him. And he's like, hey, can you please look at me? So yeah. And then, Robin is also there with Vicky in the marching band. The only thing really there in that picture, by the way, that's in the SFX magazine that will be in the Don't Show, folder. The only thing there is that Robin is looking at Vicky with this sort of, you know, glint in her eye. I think this is gonna probably be the moment, if not a moment after, Vicky kind of catches her eye and she's like, oh my goodness, a woman. So, moving on, we see this picture of the boys walking down the hall after the pep rally, and Max is nowhere to be seen. So I bet that they're talking, the way that they look, it looks like they're probably talking about what happened in there, and like, why Max is so upset, and how maybe Lucas couldn't do anything about it. Or maybe they're just talking to him about the Hellfire Club, and how they miss him, and how, hey, your basketball is kind of taking you away from us, like, it's not making you a better person, and he's trying to defend it. It could be both, it could honestly be a mix of both. But, so it looks like Max is probably going to go to Miss Kelly after that pep rally, because we see her in the school a little bit later, and it definitely is the same episode. And she's talking about, like, everything that's happened with Billy's death. Apparently Neil moved out. That's great, you know. Her mom drinking, how she's doing, how she's having nightmares and not sleeping, how she has headaches. And she's obviously lying to Miss Kelly, and Miss Kelly can probably sense that. But there's really honestly nothing much there other than that. Honestly, love the composition of this scene. Seriously, it is done so very well. These tiny little scenes that we've been getting tell me so much about how amazing this season is going to be, just based off of these little things. Can you imagine how it's going to be with the rest of the season? Off of these tiny little shots? Incredible. So, of course, we'll have Joyce getting the Russian package and note. The note says, Hop is alive. He looks forward to date. Please to make reservation call, and there's the number. Open 12 day, something that I cannot read. No government, please. Kind regards, Enzo. That is for sure, Hopper. And it looks like while she's getting those packages and everything, she's probably doing her job of being a telemarketer. So she's probably going to be like, hey, I gotta go, you know, and hangs up on them. Yeah, she's probably right after that scene maybe going to contact Murray, because Murray is probably helping her out on something like that. We know for a fact, based on somebody who actually saw the premiere of the first episode, they said that there are going to be some emotional scenes carried over by a voiceover. And there's also going to be hints towards a character's sexuality. I think they're talking about Will. There's no other character they could possibly be talking about. And it honestly doesn't surprise me. So that's where we kind of get into the California storyline and show Elle and Will at school and how they're faring. This will most likely be the diorama getting broken episode, and also like the showing off the diorama, because it looks like it's in the same day. Well, of course it's in the same day. It's the diorama. So this means this is going to be the episode where we have to watch that cringy scene again. You know, this one. I am not going to be doing very well by the end of this, let me tell you. So, yeah, Eleven's going to be out for blood. I'm very curious to see how aggressive she's actually going to be in this episode. If it might get progressively worse or maybe progressively better. I don't know. This show likes to get worse and worse until it's just overboard a little bit. So yeah, as you do. And of course, Mike will be getting that letter that Eleven sent him, either after school or even before school, you know, telling him, oh yeah, I've made lots of friends. No, sweetie, you stop lying. And I also think that this episode will have a lot of Will protecting moments. And we're going to see probably the dynamics between Jonathan, Eleven, Will, how they're all going to, like, interact with one another. We're probably gonna get a scene with them, with Argyle and Jonathan being really high because they look like they have sunglasses. So they probably are like incredibly high. They got red eyes and everything. They're like, oh yes, let's go to school like this. I mean, Jonathan was smoking and blowing that smoke out the mirror, out of the window, so. And of course, based on this clothing, based on the clothing here, it looks like Max and Dustin will go to the video store after the pep rally and meet with Robin and Steve after something terrible probably happened. Or they're just going there to hang out and, you know, just hanging out there, maybe saying, hey, do you have any, like, free movies that we can get? Just like how Steve was able to get them into the free movies when he was working at Scoops Ahoy. Probably something like that. I mean, it could be something fun and not dramatic and horrible. I mean, this could happen in the next episode, like the very beginning of the next episode, but I feel like the ending of this episode is going to include Chrissy dying to Vecna. That she is going to die in the trailer park to Vecna, and maybe the next episode will start with the body bag. This little scene. But other than that, I also think it's going to be showing us Nancy being a part of the newspaper, the high school newspaper, and, you know, saying, oh man, I need to get a story, I have a deadline. Because I feel like that's the only reason that she didn't go with Mike to California. And of course, by the end of the episode, Mike will most likely go to the airport to go visit Eleven. So that's going to be really interesting. Oh, and we're also going to see the boys at the Hellfire Club. And we're going to see Erica there as well, probably maybe them admitting her into the Hellfire Club, getting her all set up and used to it. We're going to get introduced to Eddie. We're going to get introduced to all of these amazing new characters throughout the all of the storylines. Like, it's going to be really interesting to see how it's all played out in this one episode. It's very difficult to pinpoint any of these because of the way that they've written it down already. Episode 2, Vecna's Curse. Okay, this episode, as I said before, can begin with the body bag being discovered of Chrissy, and will most likely take place probably in the same day or like the very next day. So this episode will most likely also begin with Mike arriving at the airport to meet the California gang. And we see that Ella is very talkative. That's going to be in the Can't Show Drive. It's a video behind the scenes from Noah and Millie. There is a little shot of the behind the scenes airport scene. And Eleven is just talking her head off. It is super cute. I cannot wait to hear this. Also, Peep Will in the back, it looks like he probably made a little painting, you know. He made that painting for Mike, and it looks like Mike probably did not appreciate it too much, and he's just kind of, he's like holding on to it. He looks really sad, and that makes me upset. Also, yeah, Mike literally packed everything in that suitcase. I like how everyone's making fun of that, because it is a super-sized suitcase. I don't know why he has such a big suitcase. He's not gonna be there for that long. Nancy and Robin will most likely go to the library to do some research after this, and end up stumbling upon the Creel murders. And I think there's probably going to be some other murders that happened in the town before they're like, okay, we need to investigate this. And so, like, this is definitely the same episode as these, like, this picture of them jumping out of the, like, getting out of the car. So I'm not really sure what's going on here. But I mean, it's the same clothes. So, Robin and Nancy, of course, will later on go to visit Victor Creel in the mental asylum and ask him questions about what happened on that day and why he killed his family. He, of course, will probably tell them everything about it, everything he knows, and will allude to it being a demon's fault, a vengeful demon at that, and how, oh, you know, he did this, it did that. I, of course, as I said before, think that it has something to do with illusions and making him think that he was killing a monster, but in reality he was killing his family. Then of course the Hawkins gang will regroup and head to this house at some point. I don't know if it'd be this episode exactly or the next one, considering that Dear Billy, they have the same clothes, so this most likely takes place in the same day. But if it is to happen in this episode, either way, this is how it's happening. So as they get into the house and start looking around, it looks like Max begins talking to Lucas, but he kind of looks irritated, if I'm gonna be honest. And she gets, of course, pissed off at that, And it's really hard to see, but, like, you can kind of see her mouth moving. But it looks like she might go off on her own and possibly get, you know, targeted by Vecna. Maybe she sees the actual clock, or he just is able to get into her head anyways without her seeing the actual clock. It's very possible. Because, again, we don't know how his powers work at the exact moment. We don't really know how that clock thing works. So, either way, every episode is most likely going to be showing Hopper and how he's doing in Russia. There's not really much info on Hopper at the moment. I don't really know exactly what episodes certain things for him are going to be happening. We barely have any, out of all of the storylines, we barely have anything about him. So Joyce and Murray are probably, you know, together now. We're probably going to get them, like, learning about Yuri's fish and fly. The box probably had a note alluding to, okay, you need to go to here, you need to talk to Yuri, and, like, get the ransom money over there. So they're probably trying to contact him at the moment, and that's probably when we're going to hear the pre-recorded message from Yuri. Or that pre-recorded message could also just have been a promotion, because we've gotten stuff like that before. So we might actually see them contacting him and saying, hey, we need to get over, and he's like, yeah, come over. Either way, Yuri's fish and fly is in Alaska, so they're probably going to be like, oh no, another road trip. But this will also probably be the roller rink episode, with Mike and the Cali gang going over to Rinkorama, and this is where stuff will go down, because of course it is. So Elle ends up actually getting bullied by Angela by being pulled into the roller rink and then getting laughed at. And the reason I know that she gets pulled into the rink is because, once again, the behind-the-scenes footage of that shows Angela pulling her out of her seat where she's sitting with Mike and Will. And it also seems like Jake is there as well. And we know for a fact that Eleven is in the middle of the roller rink and she's being laughed at by a bunch of people circling her. So she might end up, like, breaking down and, like, running off. And something happens to where somebody pours a drink on her because she has this stain on her dress that looks like it was, like, cola or something. It's probably New Coke that they spilled on her. And then, like, we have this shot, of course. I still have no clue, like, what this means. I really don't. They're looking at something like, oh, you know, what's going on? Oh, my goodness. I mean, they could be looking down at, like, a broken, beaten-up Angela or something. I don't know. The show is very big on their, like, surprised looks, so it could honestly be anything. But I have a feeling, once again, that Eleven is going to just beat the absolute crap out of Angela, and that's gonna be fun. I feel like that would be great. Just go ham, you know? I'd love to see it. We love to see it. So, also, when they come home, I feel like this is the shot where they look at Joyce and Murray maybe coming back, or where they're, like, meeting them. It looks like they're in, I don't know, because I don't know the layout of the house yet. It could be at the front door, or it could be down near, maybe near the dining room or something. But either way, this is definitely going to be them looking at Joyce and Murray, probably being like, we need to talk. Also, I love how Jonathan is just, he looks high. And Argyle also looks high, and he's just, it looks like Argyle's just like, hey, what's up, bro, chachos? But yeah, there's really not much on, as I said, not much on these episodes. I can't pinpoint things exactly. I will get more into some of that other stuff later. Episode 3, The Monster and the Superhero. So this episode is interesting because it actually has a quote-unquote mistranslation from the Spanish title tease that was given to us a while ago. It translated to monster or superheroine, which is a question. It changes the statement to a question, the gender of the character. So this mistranslation feels intentional, especially when you think of episode 9, The Piggyback, that also had a similar issue. But it feels intentional, especially if Eleven ends up doing what I think she's gonna do, and if she ends up getting arrested for it, it could refer to, you know, how she's been feeling, like a monster. You know, the choice. Are you a monster or are you a hero? And that kind of is a big thing for her, especially since season one. She's always called herself the monster. It could also refer to some other things. I mean, it could be a fake title, of course. I mean, all of these could... The first episode is the only one we know for a fact isn't a fake title. They could change all of them for all we know. But this is what I have to go off of. So, it could allude to anything. It could even begin with... It could even refer to the fact that this is the start of seeing the Demogorgon in the prison with Hopper. So it could be referring to both of those, because you know how they like to have their double meanings in this show. So I think this episode will have Joyce and Murray talking to the Cali gang and either lying or telling the truth about where they're going. The scene will have drama regardless of if they tell them or not. If Joyce tells them the reason why, they are definitely going to flip their lids. Either way, I feel like they're going to flip their lids. I mean, it could just be a really, really short scene, and it's just, oh, okay, you know, like, they're just having dinner together. But, I mean, it could honestly, I feel like it's going to go a little bit over the top, you know? Especially if they find out that she's lying or that she tells the truth. Yeah, Eleven's going to want to go save her dad. But, anyways, the next day after that, I think that this is going to be the episode Eleven gets arrested for probably beating the crap out of Angela or doing something. It could just be that Sullivan sends out that police, you know, the police van to go get her, or it could be Angela. Either way, they look like they're probably going to go to the police station instead of it coming to the house. So that'll be interesting. It could always, you know, have the police come get her at the house, and then they have to go to the police station to get her, but then it's like, oh, nope, prison van. And so, in this episode as well, I feel like, I mean, it's definitely gonna be in the same day. It could also be in the same episode. We're gonna see Owens breaking her out of said prison van, and then, like, bringing her to a diner to talk about, you know, hey, we kinda need you in Hawkins. So that'll be fun. And of course, she has to remind him that she doesn't have her powers, but of course he'll say, oh yeah, we have a silo lab to use. But Joyce and Murray could honestly leave by this episode. They could leave to Atlanta and begin their little road trip and possibly even encounter Yuri by this episode, by the end of this episode. And Murray does have to karate chop Yuri because he betrays them. So, I mean, we could see that happen during this episode. Could be next episode, could be this episode. Don't really know for certain. But either way, we're definitely going to... Because of the fact that the next episode is Dear Billy, we are going to be seeing Max at one of her lowest. It is just not going to be great because of the fact that she's having nightmares and stuff. And especially if Vecna is, like, starting to get his influence on her, I feel like we're really going to see that begin to kick in this episode. And kind of foreshadow what's going to happen in the next episode, which is when stuff really hits the fan. But I don't have anything else for this episode in particular. Episode 4, Dear Billy. Okay, this episode will consist of Max at the graveyard. That we know for sure. She will get put into a trance by Vecna and chased in this nightmarish hellscape, looking like she's trying to get back to her body. Like, these little things, that's Max floating in the air, and that's Dustin, Lucas, and Steve. My theory on this whole thing and why the grave has a different name from this picture to this picture, I think Vecna might have lured Max to the graveyard, pretending to be Billy's ghost for a bit, changing the name on the grave to say Billy instead of William, which is his legal name, by the way, because she knows him as Billy, not William. So another thing is, it looks like Vecna stabs Max inside of the hellscape, because if you look closely, there's blood on her clothes in two separate areas, and it looks like her blood. I'm curious to see exactly, like, what's going to be happening in that hellscape, and, like, all the things that might follow, if she's gonna be seeing a bunch of different things, if she's only gonna be in just this hellscape. Now, this is also most likely the episode in which Max has to relive Billy's death, because it says that she's at a graveyard, but then she has to relive the Starcourt Mall tragedy. So I'm going to bet that that happens before she starts floating in the air. I have a feeling, like, she's going to be put in that trance, and they're going to be there and be like, hey, are you okay? And then she's going to start floating, and it's going to be fun. There's really nothing else that I have specifically on this episode, so that's going to be Dear Billy. Episode 5, The Nina Project. So this episode is most likely just probably going to be Eleven in the Silo Lab getting her powers back. Like, I feel like that's going to be the main focus of this episode. I mean, it's literally called The Nina Project. So she will have to shave her head again and possibly go through a series of tests to get her powers back. I think they're going to, like, try everything they possibly can. And then they're going to land on, like, one thing. So I think they're going to land on The Nina Project, aka this, like, giant tankard of water. Kind of like the bath, but more compact, and it doesn't really have that, it doesn't have that, like, scuba thing. Instead, you just lay back. The only reason that I think that is because of this Funko Pop. Eleven is in her bath uniform, and she seems to have electrodes on her head, but they look waterproof now. So that tells me that she's most likely going to be laying on her back, kind of like how she was in Season 1. The reason for this is also because of the possibility of the monitors at the top. This right here would show her images and videos of things from her past that will enlighten her and bring back those memories. So I guess, like, this could be where Brenner really comes in, because he remembers what happened. He'd be like, oh, you don't remember when you killed everybody? And by this point, Sullivan's men will probably have found her by then and break into the lab fighting off the MPs. Because that's definitely military versus MPs inside of the silo lab. And we can see that these right here, these are definitely very similar together. I don't know who the guys grabbing her are. They have ID badges, so they look like they're probably with the lab. I'm not sure. But for some reason, somehow she gets her clothes back, and then she, like, goes outside and just obliterates everyone. Like, yes, you go, queen. And I feel like when the Cali gang sees that, they're just gonna be like, oh no, oh no, you are angry. So, I mean, it's gonna be heartbreaking, because that'll be the first time that they see her head shaved again. Oh, everything with her head shaved. Oh, it's literally a symbol of her growth, too, and now it's just gone. And it's most likely gone of her own will. Ugh, I hate that. But that's all I have on this episode in particular. Episode 6, The Dive. There's not very much on this, but I do know this for a fact. By this point, Eddie is 100% involved with the Upside Down and its shenanigans. Eddie will most likely be the one to be dragged into the Upside Down, probably through the portal in Lover's Lake, because of course he's at Lover's Lake, and Steve will have to go and, like, delve into the portal, most likely to find him, and then fight off the Demobats with an oar, because he's definitely at Lover's Lake based on the boats. There's really nothing else that I have on that other than the fact that they run into the forest afterwards. So, that's The Dive. Episode 7, The Massacre at Hawkins Lab. Okay, this is the big one. This is the first really, really big one. I mean, Dear Billy is going to be big considering Max is freaking levitating, but this one is the second largest episode of the season. This episode will be ranking in at 1 hour and 38 minutes. So it will be the second biggest episode of this season. That's crazy. So this is also, I mean, the Duffers describe all of the episodes as, like, mini movies, but this one and 9 in particular, they very emphasize this is like a movie, which, I mean, it literally is. So this is going to be the episode, of course, where we learn what actually happened during the massacre. Eleven is definitely going to be going back physically to the lab, possibly to regain all of her memories about this event. I think it's not what we see at face value. I don't think she killed everybody. As I said before, Vecna most likely had a big role to play in this, and somehow either one got her to kill everybody, or two, got everyone to kill each other. Either, or even got, like, got a different number to kill everybody, and then she fought that number. Either way, this episode 11 will be going through a lot of trauma and just revisiting this horrible, horrible memory that she probably shoved down. Unless, of course, Brenner made her forget this whole thing. We really don't know if she just forgot about it or if he made her forget. We don't really know. Or even if, like, she forgot about it maybe because Vecna wanted her to forget about it. Either way, she's not in control. Like, she doesn't look like she's in control at all. This is the first time her eyes bleed. That's a huge thing. But he either won. He made 11 see the clock and kill the lab people. Maybe by making her think that she had to, like, oh, you know, horrible monsters, I have to kill them. He could have possessed her. That's very possible. I mean, the way the bodies are bent is very disturbing. It's almost sadistic. It's really disgusting. But he could have also gotten everyone to kill each other with illusions and such, and just made it a whole bloodbath, and Levin just so happened to be the only one to survive. He could have even made another number attack everybody, and 11 ends up being kind of like this hero, but she maybe can't express that she saved everyone. But I highly doubt that that one is the correct answer. And the thing is, Vecna chooses his victims. It seems like he's going to be choosing his victims. If he chooses L, that would be the smartest thing. And I feel like it would be random, too. Like, he didn't choose her because, oh, you're the most powerful. No, I feel like he just chose a random number because they could all basically do the same thing. And was like, okay, kill your friends. Kill everybody in that room and in the entire lab. And so she does. And this is basically, this is another hint to the fact that Vecna is most likely number one. Why would he do this, you know, if of course that is the reason why the massacre happened in the first place, if Vecna is behind it, why else would he want that to happen if it wasn't because of the fact that he had a specific vendetta against the people in the lab and against the numbers? Trauma! So yeah, it's insane. And we know for a fact that this definitely happens before season one. And it looks like it happens probably after Kali escapes. Because we know for a fact from season two, Kali said that Eleven was moved out of her little rainbow room and that she never got to see her again after that. And soon after, Kali made her escape with her powers when she was strong enough. I think this massacre happened after Kali escaped. I don't think Kali escaped until before the massacre. It just, you know, I don't know. I feel like it just wouldn't really click as much with me. And it would make the most sense for Kali just being out of there by, you know, before then. Or even, like, escaping during that time because that place would be absolutely crazy at the time. It would make for the perfect escape. Just like how Eleven escaped when the Demogorgon was let loose and just started murdering people. It would honestly be a really good parallel if they did that. It would be kind of cool if they ended up showing Kali escaping at the same day. And it's funny because my theory before was that Brenner had something to do with it. Because out of everything, that one just seemed the most likely. Because at the time, I didn't know how Vecna's abilities worked. And how if he could, like, make people see the clock or if they had to physically see the clock. But now it's looking more and more like Vecna has the ability to do that to people without physically having them see the clock. So either way, this right here, if Vecna is a part of this, this is gonna make it so much more difficult for Eleven to fight him. You know, it's kind of like Nancy fighting him because he killed Barb, you know? Like, but it's even worse because that's technically her family. Those are innocent people. Well, innocent children. The rest of them aren't innocent. But innocent children. And then basically framed her. Like, that is horrible. But anyways, yeah, that's, it kind of also shows that Eleven's not really special. She just so happened to be the only one to survive. I really thought that she would be the most powerful. And she's not even the last number. There's like a 13th number. I don't even know how much it goes up to. So it looks like that one of those placards, because we see the 11 placard on the ground in the poster, but there's another one right next to the reflection. And I was saying, oh man, this looks like it says 10 on it. It could be 13. For all we know, it could be 13. Or it even could be 10, because 10 was kind of focused on in this little segment that we got to see. Either way, that's what I have on the massacre. Episode 8, Papa. This episode is confirmed to be 1 hour and 25 minutes. Okay, this episode was literally infuriating, because for the life of me, for the longest time, I could not figure out anything for this episode. Literally anything. If I'm being honest, I still don't really know what will really happen in this episode, because there's no actual information about this episode. Everything else at least has one thing that it's like, okay, this feels like it could definitely be from this episode. Everything else, no. I can't pinpoint it. I really can't. But the one thing that I figured is, because of the fact that it's in between the massacre episode and the finale, that right there is telling me something. It's telling me that this could possibly be the episode where, since Eleven was in the lab, maybe she stays in the lab for a little bit and does some snooping. Maybe she starts figuring out who exactly Vecna was, who Brenner was, learns that Vecna maybe was number one. And she could learn about how exactly, you know, like something happened to him, but they never figured out what it was. He just all of a sudden disappeared. And she could kind of figure, based on the abilities that he used and then the stuff that kind of just correlates with what happened at the massacre. And then when they meet up again, all the gang meets up again, they end up putting their notes together and end up realizing, oh no, Vecna is probably number one. And, like, we could probably get some insight on Brenner. And maybe, like, because if Brenner's alive, he could be there and he could end up telling her, like, about number one. He could end up, you know, giving some insight to that whole thing. And, like, I mean, I really hope they don't try to redeem Brenner, because as I said before, he's a horrible, horrible person who kidnaps children away from their families and ruins the families, possibly. Murders people, has people murdered by orders, and just everything else. He's a terrible person, and I don't want him redeemed. If this is the episode they redeem him, I don't even know. I mean, it could be a fake title for all we know. But that's all I have on this episode. Episode 9, The Piggyback. Okay, this episode is confirmed to be over 2 hours. It is confirmed to be around 2.5 hours. Jesus Christ, that is literally, that's the length of, like, most movies nowadays that are wanting to be, like, something great, like Batman or, like, MCU, you know? This is insane. This is a whole movie. Oh my God. Anyways, so this episode also has a few translations. And when I say a few, I mean a lot. Like, every title tease, except for, like, two of them, have a different translation. The translations are as such: Eleven's plan, the stealth plan, the host slash the guest, the infiltration, and the stowaway. The Duffers say that this episode has more visual effects and visuals than the entirety of season 3. Season 3. You know, the season that is very well known as being the season that has the most visual effects of the entire series. Most of it is visual effects and, like, visuals. It's, what even, how? It's funny because Vecna doesn't even have that much visual effects going on with him. He's mostly practical, apparently. So what are they using that on? I feel like they're using that with the Upside Down and that hellscape and stuff and illusions. Oh my God, they're really spending that budget. Oh, I love it. But anyways, so by the end of the season, the groups should be coming together as per usual. I mean, they keep saying that they will come together, though I'm not really too sure on Hopper and Joyce at the moment, but I mean, they could end up coming together at the end. It's the classic thing. They could come up come together, like, by the end of the last episode, or even this, at the beginning of this episode. Who knows? This episode's super long, so it could go any possible way. Imagine, though, imagine, like, Joyce and Hopper's reaction to Eleven's shaved head. Oh, that's gonna hurt. Like her two adoptive parents, and they see her like that, and they're like, oh, okay, who do I have to kill? It's gonna be great. And I just, ugh. I want her to scream, Dad, when she sees him again. If she gets to actually see him again before the finale. I'm gonna get into that in a second. So, we know for a fact that Nancy, Robin, and Eddie, as well as Steve, are in the Upside Down, going straight for Vecna. And we can base this off of their clothing, and then, like, the background. That is definitely the attic. And Nancy and Steve appear to be in Eddie's trailer, because these are the two same things, Overworld and Upside Down. And so it looks like possibly, like, they're gonna be going to the Upside Down and, like, need a way to get out easy. I'm not too certain as to what the plan for that was. But at this point, Karen will definitely start helping, so I'm curious to see where she's gonna end up, where she's gonna help. Maybe she'll, like, help evacuate, or even, like, help get the parents and stuff to, like, be cooperative, because they kind of need that cooperation. I don't know. I'm very curious to see how she might play into everything, considering that she's on the posters and everything. So, this could also be the episode where Elle, Will, and Mike are in the cabin. We know for a fact that those three are going to be in the cabin at some point, as we see in the behind-the-scenes little shoot. I'm very curious to that. I don't know when that would even possibly happen, or even why they're there in the first place. It looks like they're cleaning up. It doesn't even look like they're doing the work, you know, behind the scenes in general. It looks like they're doing that to be ready for a scene where they're cleaning up the cabin. But yeah, it's interesting because on the Monopoly cards, it says that Lucas sends the jocks to the cabin. So maybe he sends them there to get their butts whooped by Elle. I'm not sure. At some point also, Elle will definitely fight Vecna. This has been proven by Millie. We already knew it would happen because of course it is. But Millie definitely confirmed it by saying that she fights both Vecna and the Mind Flayer, that she's fought both. I'm not sure if she was even supposed to reveal that yet, but, you know. This episode is also based off of The Empire Strikes Back, which is notorious for having an ending where the villains win. Yeah, so there's a huge chance that, that this season ends with Vecna winning. I mean, there's a possibility that what he says, you have lost, that's probably the last line of the season. That would be insane, by the way. I do feel that they will lose, and Elle will have to give herself up to save her friends, as I said before with the whole ultimatum thing. I'm fully prepared for him to possess Elle and say that stuff through her. That would be the worst possible scenario, like the you have lost thing, or even saying it to her. It's gonna be horrible, you know, seeing her meet him, especially after learning possibly what he probably did in the massacre episode. She's gonna be like, oh, it's personal. It's you said it was personal. It's personal now. I do believe that season 5 is probably gonna be like Weirdmageddon. If you don't know what Weirdmageddon is, it's from the series Gravity Falls. It is a 3-episode finale, super long, where basically this demigod demon creature ascends and is, like, free from his prison and is able to take over the world now. He takes over the tiny town of Gravity Falls, though is stuck because of the fact that it has, like, a magical barrier that keeps all the weirdness in. But he begins to terrorize and torture the citizens of that town, and he's, like, super sadistic. And he kind of does remind me of Vecna. Though, like, Vecna isn't as, like, loopy and crazy and stuff. Vecna is more, not docile, but, like, way less insane as Bill. And so, the demon also, Bill also captures a character named Ford, because Ford is the only one who knows how to stop him. And so he just runs rampant, and everyone is trying to like get the group back together and like save Ford so that they can beat Bill. That's what I personally think is gonna kind of happen in this in season 5, and I feel like this finale is going to kind of lead up to that if Elle gets like captured or possessed, because I have a feeling, I mean, we've been hinting at that since season 2. I feel like, I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I've been kind of wanting that since season 2. Like, seeing a hero become a villain like that is just horrible, but at the same time, it's so fun to watch. It's so interesting to see how they pull that off, especially with a character like Elle. Perfect. Absolutely would love to see that. But, yeah, I mean, I could definitely, especially if Nancy dies, like, imagine they're in, like, an apocalyptic setting afterwards where Vecna is, like, taking over. And now they're all spread out in, like, the Upside Down and the Overworld. Now, like, the monsters are running rampant, taking over. Like, I'm very interested to see exactly where that goes. But, as, I mean, it's kind of interesting how I don't actually have that very much on the finale. But, I mean, I did have more than most of them. So, that's my take on the finale. Outro. Oh boy, okay. That was a lot. I feel like I definitely missed some stuff. I most likely did. Like, knowing me, I've been working on this since the trailer came out. And I have done a lot of revamping. I have made 2 separate documents. The normal version and then the revamped version that I'm using for this video. I have changed my theories quite a few times. I ended up actually being right about quite a few things before they were revealed, which was super insane. I was super excited about that. And it kind of made me more excited to get into the theories and talk about them. And so, yeah. And I've been obsessed with this show for about 4 months now, 4 months straight. So at least I'm finally using this obsession to do something worthwhile instead of just sitting at my computer, not even wanting to do anything because I'm just so obsessed with this show. When people tell you obsession is bad, honestly, it's horrible. I hate this. I really do hate this. The only thing that I really hope that my obsession lasts long enough for is to make animations and edits, because I have always really wanted to do that for stuff like this, but then my obsession or like my fixation on it just kind of dies out. It's a weird process where I love something for like maybe a few days to a week where it's like all I can talk about, then all of a sudden I'm like, nope, okay, next thing. I get bored. This is the one time that's never happened. This has been 4 months straight. I have never had a show or anything at all that has had me this fixated on it. I hate it. So anyways, please check out the document and the drive in the description below. Also, please check out the Stranger Things Discord that I'm in. It is so fun. It is so insane. I love it so much. Hopefully, I'll be able to stay in there for a while longer. Maybe even stay in there until season 5 comes out. Super awesome. Everyone's super kind. And I really hope that you guys have some good discussions about this in the comments. I hope that you can share this video around. I spent a lot of time making it. I've never done anything like this before. I mean, I've done theory videos, but nothing like this. This is the most research I've ever done for anything. Like, weeks and weeks worth of research, constantly keeping updated on everything. It's been rough, but at the same time, it's been really, really fun. I like being the all-knowing. Oh, and by the way, if I see any bad comments or, like, leaks or anything, I will be sending you to the gulag with Hopper. With the Demogorgon, actually. You don't deserve to be with Hopper. You're just going straight to the Demogorgon's cage. But anyways, so Stranger Things 4 is coming out in 1 week. So you guys can watch the first 7 episodes of Stranger Things Season 4, Volume 1, when it comes out on May 27th at midnight Pacific Standard Time. For other people, it's 3 a.m. or 6. I don't know. It's different for each time zone, so make sure that you look at your time zone. It basically comes out at the normal Netflix rate. Netflix usually publishes everything at the same exact time. And Volume 2 will be coming out the same time, but on July 1st, that will have 2 episodes, which will be around 4 hours long. Both of them together are 4 hours long. That's crazy. So, anyways, thank you guys for watching. Thank you so much for listening to my little rambles and everything. and I hope that you enjoy this volume just as much as I am definitely going to enjoy this volume. It has surpassed my expectations every single time something's been posted. I am so excited.